Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The 33 Strategies of War by Robert Greene, narrated by Donald Coren.
Preface. We live in a culture that promotes democratic values of being fair to one and all, the importance of fitting into a group, and knowing how to cooperate with other people. We are taught early on in life that those who are outwardly combative and aggressive pay a social price: unpopularity and isolation. These values of harmony and cooperation are perpetuated in subtle and not so subtle ways, through books on how to be successful in life, through the pleasant, peaceful exteriors that those who have gotten ahead in the world present to the public, through notions of correctness that saturate the public space. The problem for us is that we are trained and prepared for peace, and we are not at all prepared for what confronts us in the real world: war. This war exists on several levels. Most obviously, we have our rivals on the other side. The world has become increasingly competitive and nasty. In politics, business, even the arts, we face opponents who will do almost anything to gain an edge. More troubling and complex, however, are the battles we face with those who are supposedly on our side. There are those who outwardly play the team game, who act very friendly and agreeable, but who sabotage us behind the scenes, use the group to promote their own agenda. Others, more difficult to spot, play subtle games of passive aggression, offering help that never comes, instilling guilt as a secret weapon. On the surface, everything seems peaceful enough, but just below it, it is every man and woman for him or herself. This dynamic infecting even families and relationships. The culture may deny this reality and promote a gentler picture, but we know it and feel it in our battle scars. It is not that we and our colleagues are ignoble creatures who fail to live up to ideals of peace and selflessness, but that we cannot help the way we are. We have aggressive impulses that are impossible to ignore or repress. In the past, individuals could expect a group, the state, an extended family, a company, to take care of them. But this is no longer the case. And in this uncaring world, we have to think first and foremost of ourselves and our interests. What we need are not impossible and inhuman ideals of peace and cooperation to live up to, and the confusion that brings us, but rather practical knowledge on how to deal with conflict and the daily battles we face. And this knowledge is not about how to be more forceful in getting what we want or defending ourselves, but rather how to be more rational and strategic when it comes to conflict, channeling our aggressive impulses instead of denying or repressing them. If there is an ideal to aim for, it should be that of the strategic warrior, the man or woman who manages difficult situations and people through deft and intelligent maneuver. Many psychologists and sociologists have argued that it is through conflict that problems are often solved and real differences reconciled. Our successes and failures in life can be traced to how well or how badly we deal with the inevitable conflicts that confront us in society. The common ways that people deal with them, trying to avoid all conflict, getting emotional and lashing out, turning sly and manipulative, are all counterproductive in the long run, because they are not under conscious and rational control and often make the situation worse. Strategic warriors operate much differently. They think ahead toward their long-term goals, decide which fights to avoid and which are inevitable, know how to control and channel their emotions. When forced to fight, they do so with indirection and subtle maneuver, making their manipulations hard to trace. In this way, they can maintain the peaceful exterior so cherished in these political times. This ideal of fighting rationally comes to us from organized warfare, where the art of strategy was invented and refined. In the beginning, war was not at all strategic. Battles between tribes were fought in a brutal manner, a kind of ritual of violence in which individuals could display their heroism. But as tribes expanded and evolved into states, it became all too apparent that war had too many hidden costs, that waging it blindly often led to exhaustion and self-destruction, even for the victor, Somehow wars had to be fought more rationally. The word strategy comes from the ancient Greek word strategos, meaning literally the leader of the army. Strategy in this sense was the art of generalship, of commanding the entire war effort, deciding what formations to deploy, what terrain to fight on, what maneuvers to use to gain an edge. And as this knowledge progressed, military leaders discovered that the more they thought and planned ahead, the more possibilities they had for success. Novel strategies could allow them to defeat much larger armies, as Alexander the Great did in his victories over the Persians. In facing savvy opponents, who were also using strategy, there developed an upward pressure. To gain an advantage, a general had to be even more strategic, more indirect and clever than the other side. Over time, the arts of generalship became steadily more sophisticated as more strategies were invented. Although the word strategy itself is Greek in origin, the concept appears in all cultures, in all periods. Solid principles on how to deal with the inevitable accidents of war, how to craft the ultimate plan, how to best organize the army, all of this can be found in war manuals from ancient China to modern Europe. The counterattack, the flanking or enveloping maneuver, and the arts of deception are common to the armies of Genghis Khan, Napoleon, and the Zulu king Shaka. As a whole, these principles and strategies indicate a kind of universal military wisdom, a set of adaptable patterns that can increase the chances for victory. Perhaps the greatest strategist of all was Sun Tzu, author of the ancient Chinese classic The Art of War. In his book, written probably in the 4th century BC, can be found traces of almost all the strategic patterns and principles later developed over the course of centuries. But what connects them, in fact what constitutes the art of war itself in Sun Tzu's eyes, is the ideal of winning without bloodshed. By playing on the psychological weaknesses of the opponent, by maneuvering him into precarious positions, by inducing feelings of frustration and confusion, a strategist can get the other side to break down mentally before surrendering physically. In this way, victory can be had at a much lower cost. And the state that wins wars with few lives lost and resources squandered is the state that can thrive over greater periods of time. Certainly most wars are not waged so rationally, but those campaigns in history that have followed this principle, Scipio Africanus in Spain, Napoleon at Ulm, T.E. Lawrence in the desert campaigns of World War I, stand out above the rest and serve as the ideal. War is not some separate realm divorced from the rest of society. It is an eminently human arena, full of the best and the worst of our nature. War also reflects trends in society. The evolution toward more unconventional, dirtier strategies, guerrilla warfare, terrorism, mirrors a similar evolution in society, where almost anything goes. The strategies that succeed in war, whether conventional or unconventional, are based on timeless psychology, and great military failures have much to teach us about human stupidity and the limits of force in any arena. The strategic ideal in war, being supremely rational and emotionally balanced, striving to win with minimum bloodshed and loss of resources, has infinite application and relevance to our daily battles. Inculcated with the values of our times, many will argue that organized war is inherently barbaric, a relic of man's violent past and something to be overcome for good. To promote the arts of warfare in a social setting, they will say, is to stand in the way of progress and to encourage conflict and dissension. Isn't there enough of that in the world? This argument is very seductive, but not at all reasonable. There will always be those in society and in the world at large who are more aggressive than we are, who find ways to get what they want by hook or by crook. We must be vigilant and must know how to defend ourselves against such types. Civilized values are not furthered if we are forced to surrender to those who are crafty and strong. In fact, being pacifists in the face of such wolves is the source of endless tragedy. Mahatma Gandhi, who elevated nonviolence into a great weapon for social change, had one simple goal later on in his life: to rid India of the British overlords who had crippled it for so many centuries. The British were clever rulers. Gandhi understood that if nonviolence were to work, it would have to be extremely strategic, demanding much thought and planning. He went so far as to call nonviolence a new way of waging war. To promote any value, even peace and pacifism, you must be willing to fight for it and to aim at results, not simply the good, warm feeling that expressing such ideas might bring you. The moment you aim for results, you are in the realm of strategy. War and strategy have an inexorable logic. If you want or desire anything, you must be ready and able to fight for it. Others will argue that war and strategy are primarily matters that concern men, particularly those who are aggressive or among the power elite. The study of war and strategy, they will say, is a masculine, elitist, and repressive pursuit, a way for power to perpetuate itself. Such an argument is dangerous nonsense. In the beginning, strategy indeed belonged to a select few: a general, his staff, the king, a handful of courtiers. Soldiers were not taught strategy, for that would not have helped them on the battlefield. Besides, it was unwise to arm one's soldiers with the kind of practical knowledge that could help them to organize a mutiny or rebellion. The era of colonialism took this principle further. The indigenous peoples of Europe's colonies were conscripted into the Western armies and did much of the police work, but even those who rose to the upper echelons were rigorously kept ignorant of knowledge of strategy, which was considered far too dangerous for them to know. To maintain strategy and the arts of war as a branch of specialized knowledge is actually to play into the hands of the elites and repressive powers, who like to divide and conquer. If strategy is the art of getting results, of putting ideas into practice, then it should be spread far and wide, particularly among those who have been traditionally kept ignorant of it, including women. In the mythologies of almost all cultures, the great gods of war are women, including Athena of ancient Greece. A woman's lack of interest in strategy and war is not biological, but social and perhaps political. Instead of resisting the pull of strategy and the virtues of rational warfare, or imagining that it is beneath you, it is far better to confront its necessity. Mastering the art will only make your life more peaceful and productive in the long run, for you will know how to play the game and win without violence. Ignoring it will lead to a life of endless confusion and defeat. The following are six fundamental ideals you should aim for in transforming yourself into a strategic warrior in daily life. Look at things as they are, not as your emotions color them. In strategy, you must see your emotional responses to events as a kind of disease that must be remedied. Fear will make you overestimate the enemy and act too defensively. Anger and impatience will draw you into rash actions that will cut off your options. Overconfidence, particularly as a result of success, will make you go too far. Love and affection will blind you to the treacherous maneuvers of those apparently on your side. Even the subtlest gradations of these emotions can color the way you look at events. The only remedy is to be aware that the pull of emotion is inevitable, to notice it when it is happening, and to compensate for it. When you have success, be extra wary. When you are angry, take no action. When you are fearful, know you are going to exaggerate the dangers you face. War demands the utmost in realism, seeing things as they are. The more you can limit or compensate for your emotional responses, the closer you will come to this ideal. Judge people by their actions. The brilliance of warfare is that no amount of eloquence or talk can explain away a failure on the battlefield. A general has led his troops to defeat, lives have been wasted, and that is how history will judge him. You must strive to apply this ruthless standard in your daily life, judging people by the results of their actions, the deeds that can be seen and measured, the maneuvers they have used to gain power. What people say about themselves does not matter. People will say anything. Look at what they have done. Deeds do not lie. You must also apply this logic to yourself. In looking back at a defeat, you must identify the things you could have done differently. It is your own bad strategies, not the unfair opponent, that are to blame for your failures. You are responsible for the good and bad in your life. As a corollary to this, look at everything other people do as a strategic maneuver, an attempt to gain victory. People who accuse you of being unfair, for example, who try to make you feel guilty, who talk about justice and morality, are trying to gain an advantage on the chessboard. Depend on your own arms. In the search for success in life, people tend to rely on things that seem simple and easy, or that have worked before. This could mean accumulating wealth, resources, a large number of allies, or the latest technology and the advantage it brings. This is being materialistic and mechanical. But true strategy is psychological, a matter of intelligence, not material force. Everything in life can be taken away from you, and generally will be at some point. Your wealth vanishes. The latest gadgetry suddenly becomes passé. Your allies desert you. But if your mind is armed with the art of war, there is no power that can take that away. In the middle of a crisis, your mind will find its way to the right solution. Having superior strategies at your fingertips will give your maneuvers irresistible force. As Sun-Tzu says, being unconquerable lies with yourself. Worship Athena, not Ares. In the mythology of ancient Greece, the cleverest immortal of them all was the goddess Metis. To prevent her from outwitting and destroying him, Zeus married her, then swallowed her whole, hoping to incorporate her wisdom in the process. But Metis was pregnant with Zeus's child, the goddess Athena, who was subsequently born from his forehead. As befitting her lineage, she was blessed with the craftiness of Metis and the warrior mentality of Zeus. She was deemed by the Greeks to be the goddess of strategic warfare, her favorite mortal and acolyte being the crafty Odysseus. Ares was the god of war in its direct and brutal form. The Greeks despised Ares and worshipped Athena, who always fought with the utmost intelligence and subtlety. Your interest in war is not the violence, the brutality, the waste of lives and resources, but the rationality and pragmatism it forces on us, and the ideal of winning without bloodshed. The Ares figures of the world are actually quite stupid and easily misled. Using the wisdom of Athena, your goal is to turn the violence and aggression of such types against them, making their brutality the cause of their downfall. Like Athena, you are always one step ahead, making your moves more indirect. Your goal is to blend philosophy and war, wisdom and battle, into an unbeatable blend. Elevate yourself above the battlefield. In war, strategy is the art of commanding the entire military operation. Tactics, on the other hand, is the skill of forming up the army for battle itself and dealing with the immediate needs of the battlefield. Most of us in life are tacticians, not strategists. We become so enmeshed in the conflicts we face that we can think only of how to get what we want in the battle we are currently facing. To think strategically is difficult and unnatural. You may imagine you are being strategic, but in all likelihood you are merely being tactical. To have the power that only strategy can bring, you must be able to elevate yourself above the battlefield, to focus on your long-term objectives, to craft an entire campaign, to get out of the reactive mode that so many battles in life lock you into. Keeping your overall goals in mind, it becomes much easier to decide when to fight and when to walk away. That makes the tactical decisions of daily life much simpler and more rational. Tactical people are heavy and stuck in the ground. Strategists are light on their feet and can see far and wide. Spiritualize your warfare. Every day you face battles. That is the reality for all creatures in their struggle to survive. But the greatest battle of all is with yourself. Your weaknesses, your emotions, your lack of resolution in seeing things through to the end. You must declare increasing war on yourself. As a warrior in life, you welcome combat and conflict as ways to prove yourself, to better your skills, to gain courage, confidence, and experience. Instead of repressing your doubts and fears, you must face them down, do battle with them. You want more challenges and you invite more war. You are forging the warrior spirit, and only constant practice will lead you there. The 33 Strategies of War is a distillation of the timeless wisdom contained in the lessons and principles of warfare. The book is designed to arm you with practical knowledge that will give you endless options and advantages in dealing with the elusive warriors that attack you in daily battle. Each chapter is a strategy aimed at solving a particular problem that you will often encounter. Such problems include fighting with an unmotivated army behind you, wasting energy by battling on too many fronts, feeling overwhelmed by friction, the discrepancy between plans and reality, getting into situations you cannot get out of. You can read the chapters that apply to the particular problem of the moment. Better still, you can read all of the strategies, absorb them, allowing them to become part of your mental arsenal. Even when you are trying to avoid a war, not fight one, many of these strategies are worth knowing for defensive purposes and for making yourself aware of what the other side might be up to. In any event, they are not intended as doctrine or formulas to be repeated, but as aids to judgment in the heat of battle, seeds that will take root in you and help you think for yourself, developing the latent strategist within. The strategies themselves are culled from the writings and practices of the greatest generals in history: Alexander the Great, Hannibal, Genghis Khan, Napoleon Bonaparte, Shaka Zulu, William Tecumseh Sherman, Arvin Rommel, Von Wyn Zapp, as well as the greatest strategists: Sun Tzu, Miyamoto Musashi, Karl von Clausewitz, Ardan de Pique, T.E. Lawrence, Colonel John Boyd. They range from the basic strategies of classical warfare to the dirty, unconventional strategies of modern times. The book is divided into five parts: self-directed war, how to prepare your mind and spirit for battle; organizational war, how to structure and motivate your army; defensive war, offensive war; and unconventional, dirty war. Each chapter is illustrated with historical examples, not only from warfare itself, but from politics: Margaret Thatcher; culture, Alfred Hitchcock; sports, Muhammad Ali; business, John D. Rockefeller, showing the intimate connection between the military and the social. These strategies can be applied to struggles of every scale: organized warfare, business battles, the politics of a group, even personal relationships. Finally, strategy is an art that requires not only a different way of thinking, but an entirely different approach to life itself. Too often there is a chasm between our ideas and knowledge on the one hand, and our actual experience on the other. We absorb trivia and information that takes up mental space but gets us nowhere. We read books that divert us but have little relevance to our daily lives. We have lofty ideas that we do not put into practice. We also have many rich experiences that we do not analyze enough, that do not inspire us with ideas, whose lessons we ignore. Strategy requires a constant contact between the two realms. It is practical knowledge of the highest form. Events in life mean nothing if you do not reflect on them in a deep way, and ideas from books are pointless if they have no application to life as you live it. In strategy, all of life is a game that you are playing. This game is exciting, but also requires deep and serious attention. The stakes are so high. What you know must translate into action, and action must translate into knowledge. In this way, strategy becomes a lifelong challenge and the source of constant pleasure in surmounting difficulties and solving problems. Here are further reflections on the concept of strategy. by Arthur Schopenhauer in Counsels and Maxims. In this world, where the game is played with loaded dice, a man must have a temper of iron, with armor proof to the blows of fate, and weapons to make his way against men. Life is one long battle. We have to fight at every step. And Voltaire very rightly says that if we succeed, it is at the point of the sword, and that we die with the weapon in our hand. From the Book of Job. The life of man upon earth is a warfare. By Vegetius, in the 4th century A.D. Let him who wants peace prepare for war. By Helmut von Moltke. Strategy is more than a science. It is the application of knowledge to practical life, the development of thought capable of modifying the original guiding idea in the light of ever-changing situations. It is the art of acting under the pressure of the most difficult conditions. From The Iliad by Homer. Well then, my boy, develop your strategy so that prizes in games won't elude your grasp. Strategy makes a better woodcutter than strength. Strategy keeps a pilot's ship on course when crosswinds blow it over the wine-blue sea. And strategy wins races for charioteers. One type of driver trusts his horses and car and swerves mindlessly this way and that, all over the course without reining his horses. But a man who knows how to win with lesser horses keeps his eye on the post and cuts the turn close, and from the start keeps tension on the reins with a firm hand as he watches the leader. From the Bhagavad Gita. The self is the friend of a man who masters himself through the self. But for a man without self-mastery, the self is like an enemy at war. From the Greek Myths by Robert Graves. Although a goddess of war, Athena gets no pleasure from battle, but rather from settling disputes and upholding the law by pacific means. She bears no arms in times of peace, and if ever she needs any, will usually borrow a set from Zeus. Her mercy is great, yet once engaged in battle, she never loses the day even against Ares himself, being better grounded in tactics and strategy than he, and wise captains always approach her for advice. From the Iliad by Homer. And Athena, whose eyes were as gray as owls. Diomedes, son of Tydeus, you don't have to fear Ares or any other of the immortals. Look who is here beside you. Drive your horses directly at Ares, and when you're in range, strike. Don't be in awe of Ares. He's nothing but a shifty lout. And when Diomedes thrust next, she drove his spear home to the pit of Ares' belly, where the kilt piece covered it. Ares quickly scaled the heights of Olympus, sat down sulking beside Cronian Zeus, showed him the immortal blood oozing from his wound, and whined these winged words, "Father Zeus, doesn't it infuriate you to see this violence? We gods get the worst of it from each other whenever we try to help out men." And Zeus, from under thunderhead brows, "Shifty lout, don't sit here by me and whine. You're the most loathsome god on Olympus. You actually like fighting and war. You take after your hard-headed mother, Hera. I can barely control her either. Be that as it may, I cannot tolerate your being in pain." And he called upon Paeon to doctor his wound. Then back to the palace of great Zeus came Argive Hera and Athena the protector, having stopped brutal Ares from butchering men. By Friedrich Nietzsche. Against war, it can be said, it makes the victor stupid, the defeated malicious. In favor of war, through production these two effects it barbarizes and therefore makes more natural. It is the winter or hibernation time of culture. Mankind emerges from it stronger for good and evil. By Fyodor Dostoevsky. Without war, human beings stagnate in comfort and affluence, and lose the capacity for great thoughts and feelings. They become cynical and subside into barbarism. And lastly, by Ralph Waldo Emerson. Nature has made up her mind that what cannot defend itself shall not be defended. Part 1. Self-directed warfare. War, or any kind of conflict, is waged and won through strategy. Think of strategy as a series of lines and arrows aimed at a goal, at getting you to a certain point in the world, at helping you to attack a problem in your path, at figuring out how to encircle and destroy your enemy. Before directing these arrows at your enemies, however, you must first direct them at yourself. Your mind is the starting point of all war and all strategy. A mind that is easily overwhelmed by emotion, that is rooted in the past instead of the present, that cannot see the world with clarity and urgency, will create strategies that will always miss the mark. To become a true strategist, you must take three steps. First, become aware of the weakness and illness that can take hold of the mind, warping its strategic powers. Second, declare a kind of war on yourself to make yourself move forward. Third, wage ruthless and continual battle on the enemies within you by applying certain strategies. The following four chapters are designed to make you aware of the disorders that are probably flourishing in your mind right now and to arm you with specific strategies for eliminating them. These chapters are arrows to aim at yourself. Once you have absorbed them through thought and practice, they will serve as a self-corrective device in all your future battles, freeing the grand strategist within you. Chapter 1. Declare war on your enemies. The polarity strategy. Life is endless battle and conflict, and you cannot fight effectively unless you can identify your enemies. People are subtle and evasive, disguising their intentions, pretending to be on your side. You need clarity. Learn to smoke out your enemies, to spot them by the signs and patterns that reveal hostility. Then, once you have them in your sights, inwardly declare war. As the opposite poles of a magnet create motion, your enemies, your opposites, can fill you with purpose and direction. As people who stand in your way, who represent what you loathe, people to react against, they are a source of energy. Do not be naive. With some enemies, there can be no compromise, no middle ground. The inner enemy. In the spring of 401 BC, Xenophon, a 30-year-old country gentleman who lived outside Athens, received an intriguing invitation. A friend was recruiting Greek soldiers to fight as mercenaries for Cyrus, brother of Persian King Artaxerxes, and asked him to go along. The request was somewhat unusual. The Greeks and the Persians had long been bitter enemies. Some 80 years earlier, in fact, Persia had tried to conquer Greece. But the Greeks, renowned fighters, had begun to offer their services to the highest bidder, and within the Persian Empire, there were rebellious cities that Cyrus wanted to punish. Greek mercenaries would be the perfect reinforcements in his large army. Xenophon was not a soldier. In fact, he had led a coddled life, raising dogs and horses, traveling into Athens to talk philosophy with his good friend Socrates, living off his inheritance. He wanted adventure, though. And here he had a chance to meet the great Cyrus, learn war, see Persia. Perhaps, when it was all over, he would write a book. He would go not as a mercenary, he was too wealthy for that, but as a philosopher and historian. After consulting the oracle at Delphi, he accepted the invitation. Some 10,000 Greek soldiers joined Cyrus's punitive expedition. The mercenaries were a motley crew from all over Greece, there for the money and the adventure. They had a good time of it for a while, but a few months into the job, after leading them deep into Persia, Cyrus admitted his true purpose. He was marching on Babylon, mounting a civil war to unseat his brother and make himself king. Unhappy to be deceived, the Greeks argued and complained, but Cyrus offered them more money, and that quieted them. The armies of Cyrus and Artaxerxes met on the plains of Cunaxa, not far from Babylon. Early in the battle, Cyrus was killed, putting a quick end to the war. Now, the Greeks' position was suddenly precarious. Having fought on the wrong side of a civil war, they were far from home and surrounded by hostile Persians. They were soon told, however, that Artaxerxes had no quarrel with them. His only desire was that they leave Persia as quickly as possible. He even sent them an envoy, the Persian commander Tissaphernes, to provision them and escort them back to Greece. And so, guided by Tissaphernes and the Persian army, the mercenaries began the long trek home, some 1,500 miles. A few days into the march, the Greeks had new fears. Their supplies from the Persians were insufficient, and the route that Tissaphernes had chosen for them was problematic. Could they trust these Persians? They started to argue among themselves. The Greek commander Clearchus expressed his soldiers' concerns to Tissaphernes, who was sympathetic. Clearchus should bring his captains to a meeting at a neutral site. The Greeks would voice their grievances, and the two sides would come to an understanding. Clearchus agreed and appeared the next day with his officers at the appointed time and place, where, however, a large contingent of Persians surrounded and arrested them. They were beheaded that same day. One man managed to escape and warn the Greeks of the Persian treachery. That evening, the Greek camp was a desolate place. Some men argued and accused, others slumped drunk to the ground. A few considered flight, but with their leaders dead, they felt doomed. That night, Xenophon, who had stayed mostly on the sidelines during the expedition, had a dream. A lightning bolt from Zeus set fire to his father's house. He woke up in a sweat. It suddenly struck him. Death was staring the Greeks in the face, yet they lay around moaning, despairing, arguing. The problem was in their heads. Fighting for money rather than for a purpose or cause, unable to distinguish between friend and foe, they had gotten lost. The barrier between them and home was not rivers or mountains or the Persian army, but their own muddled state of mind. Xenophon didn't want to die in this disgraceful way. He was no military man, but he knew philosophy and the way men think, and he believed that if the Greeks concentrated on the enemies who wanted to kill them, they would become alert and creative. If they focused on the vile treachery of the Persians, they would grow angry, and their anger would motivate them. They had to stop being confused mercenaries and go back to being Greeks, the polar opposite of the faithless Persians. What they needed was clarity and direction. Xenophon decided to be Zeus's lightning bolt, waking the men up and illuminating their way. He called a meeting of all the surviving officers and stated his plan. "We will declare war without parley on the Persians. No more thoughts of bargaining or debate. We will waste no more time on argument or accusation among ourselves. Every ounce of our energy will be spent on the Persians. We will be as inventive and inspired as our ancestors at Marathon, who fought off a vastly larger Persian army. We will burn our wagons, live off the land, move fast. We will not for one second lay down our arms or forget the dangers around us. It is us or them, life or death, good or evil. Should any man try to confuse us with clever talk or with vague ideas of appeasement, we will declare him too stupid and cowardly to be on our side, and we will drive him away. Let the Persians make us merciless. We must be consumed with one idea, getting home alive." The officers knew that Xenophon was right. The next day, a Persian officer came to see them, offering to act as an ambassador between them and Artaxerxes. Following Xenophon's counsel, he was quickly and rudely driven away. It was now war and nothing else. Roused to action, the Greeks elected leaders, Xenophon among them, and began the march home. Forced to depend on their wits, they quickly learned to adapt to the terrain, to avoid battle, to move at night. They successfully eluded the Persians, beating them to a key mountain pass and moving through it before they could be caught. Although many enemy tribes still lay between them and Greece, the dreaded Persian army was now behind them. It took several years, but almost all of them returned to Greece alive. Interpretation. Life is battle and struggle, and you will constantly find yourself facing bad situations, destructive relationships, dangerous engagements. How you confront these difficulties will determine your fate. As Xenophon said, your obstacles are not rivers or mountains or other people. Your obstacle is yourself. If you feel lost and confused, if you lose your sense of direction, if you cannot tell the difference between friend and foe, you have only yourself to blame. Think of yourself as always about to go into battle. Everything depends on your frame of mind and on how you look at the world. A shift of perspective can transform you from a passive and confused mercenary into a motivated and creative fighter. We are defined by our relationship to other people. As children, we develop an identity by differentiating ourselves from others, even to the point of pushing them away, rejecting them, rebelling. The more clearly you recognize who you do not want to be, then the clearer your sense of identity and purpose will be. Without a sense of that polarity, without an enemy to react against, you are as lost as the Greek mercenaries. Duped by other people's treachery, you hesitate at the fatal moment and descend into whining and argument. Focus on an enemy. It can be someone who blocks your path or sabotages you, whether subtly or obviously. It can be someone who has hurt you, or someone who has fought you unfairly. It can be a value or an idea that you loathe and that you see in an individual or group. It can be an abstraction, stupidity, smugness, vulgar materialism. Do not listen to people who say that the distinction between friend and enemy is primitive and passé. They are just disguising their fear of conflict behind a front of false warmth. They are trying to push you off course, to infect you with the vagueness that inflicts them. Once you feel clear and motivated, you will have space for true friendship and true compromise. Your enemy is the polar star that guides you. Given that direction, you can enter battle. From the book of Luke, "He that is not with me is against me." The outer enemy. In the early 1970s, the British political system had settled into a comfortable pattern. The Labour Party would win an election, and then the next time around, the Conservatives would win. Back and forth the power went, all fairly genteel and civilized. In fact, the two parties had come to resemble one another. But when the Conservatives lost in 1974, some of them had had enough. Wanting to shake things up, they proposed Margaret Thatcher as their leader. The party was divided that year, and Thatcher took advantage of the split and won the nomination. No one had ever seen a politician quite like Thatcher. A woman in a world run by men, she was also proudly middle class, the daughter of a grocer, in the traditional party of the aristocracy. Her clothes were prim, more like a housewife's than a politician's. She had not been a player in the Conservative Party. In fact, she was on its right-wing fringes. Most striking of all was her style. Where other politicians were smooth and conciliatory, she confronted her opponents, attacking them directly. She had an appetite for battle. Most politicians saw Thatcher's election as a fluke and didn't expect her to last. And in her first few years leading the party, when Labour was in power, she did little to change their opinion. She railed against the socialist system, which in her mind had choked all initiative and was largely responsible for the decline of the British economy. She criticized the Soviet Union at a time of détente. Then, in the winter of 1978 to 79, several public sector unions decided to strike. Thatcher went on the warpath, linking the strikes to the Labour Party and Prime Minister James Callaghan. This was bold, divisive talk, good for making the evening news, but not for winning elections. You had to be gentle with the voters, reassure them, not frighten them. At least, that was the conventional wisdom. In 1979, the Labour Party called a general election. Thatcher kept on the attack, categorizing the election as a crusade against socialism and as Great Britain's last chance to modernize. Callaghan was the epitome of the genteel politician, but Thatcher got under his skin. He had nothing but disdain for this housewife-turned-politician, and he returned her fire. He agreed that the election was a watershed, for if Thatcher won, she would send the economy into shock. The strategy seemed partly to work. Thatcher scared many voters, and the polls that tracked personal popularity showed that her numbers had fallen well below Callahan's. At the same time, though, her rhetoric, and Callahan's response to it, polarized the electorate, which could finally see a sharp difference between the parties. Dividing the public into left and right, she charged into the breach, sucking in attention and attracting the undecided. She won a sizable victory. Thatcher had bowled over the voters, but now as prime minister she would have to moderate her tone, heal the wounds. According to the polls, at any rate, that was what the public wanted. But Thatcher, as usual, did the opposite, enacting budget cuts that went even deeper than she had proposed during the campaign. As her policies played out, the economy did indeed go into shock, as Callahan had said it would, and unemployment soared. Men in her own party, many of whom had by that point been resenting her treatment of them for years, began publicly to question her abilities. These men, whom she called the Wets, were the most respected members of the Conservative Party, and they were in a panic. She was leading the country into an economic disaster that they were afraid they would pay for with their careers. Thatcher's response was to purge them from her cabinet. She seemed bent on pushing everyone away. Her legion of enemies was growing, her poll numbers slipping still lower. Surely the next election would be her last. Then, in 1982, on the other side of the Atlantic, the military junta that ruled Argentina, needing a cause to distract the country from its many problems, invaded the Falkland Islands, a British possession to which, however, Argentina had a historical claim. The officers of the junta felt certain that the British would abandon these islands, barren and remote, but Thatcher did not hesitate. Despite the distance, 8,000 miles, she sent a naval task force to the Falklands. Labor leaders attacked her for this pointless and costly war. Many in her own party were terrified. If the attempt to retake the islands failed, the party would be ruined. Thatcher was more alone than ever. But much of the public now saw her qualities, which had seemed so irritating, in a new light. Her obstinacy became courage, nobility. Compared to the dithering, panty-waisted, careerist men around her, Thatcher seemed resolute and confident. The British successfully won back the Falklands, and Thatcher stood taller than ever. Suddenly, the country's economic and social problems were forgotten. Thatcher now dominated the scene, and in the next two elections, she crushed Labour. Interpretation. Margaret Thatcher came to power as an outsider, a middle-class woman, a right-wing radical. The first instinct of most outsiders who attain power is to become insiders. Life on the outside is hard. But in doing so, they lose their identity, their difference, the thing that makes them stand out in the public eye. If Thatcher had become like the men around her, she would simply have been replaced by yet another man. Her instinct was to stay an outsider. In fact, she pushed being an outsider as far as it could go. She set herself up as one woman against an army of men. At every step of the way, to give her the contrast she needed, Thatcher marked out an opponent. The socialists, the Wets, the Argentinians. These enemies helped to define her image as determined, powerful, self-sacrificing. Thatcher was not seduced by popularity, which is ephemeral and superficial. Pundits might obsess over popularity numbers, but in the mind of the voter, which for a politician is the field of battle, a dominating presence has more pull than does likability. Let some of the public hate you, you cannot please everyone. Your enemies, those you stand sharply against, will help you to forge a support base that will not desert you. Do not crowd into the center where everyone else is. There is no room to fight in a crowd. Polarize people. Drive some of them away, and create a space for battle. Everything in life conspires to push you into the center, and not just politically. The center is the realm of compromise. Getting along with other people is an important skill to have, but it comes with a danger. By always seeking the path of least resistance, the path of conciliation, you forget who you are, and you sink into the center with everyone else. Instead, see yourself as a fighter, an outsider surrounded by enemies. Constant battle will keep you strong and alert. It will help to define what you believe in, both for yourself and for others. Do not worry about antagonizing people. Without antagonism, there is no battle, and without battle, there is no chance of victory. Do not be lured by the need to be liked. Better to be respected, even feared. Victory over your enemies will bring you a more lasting popularity. From The Art of War by Sun-Tzu. Don't depend on the enemy not coming. Depend rather on being ready for him. Keys to Warfare. We live in an era in which people are seldom directly hostile. The rules of engagement, social, political, military, have changed, and so must your notion of the enemy. An upfront enemy is rare now and is actually a blessing. People hardly ever attack you openly anymore, showing their intentions, their desire to destroy you. Instead, they are political and indirect. Although the world is more competitive than ever, outward aggression is discouraged, so people have learned to go underground, to attack unpredictably and craftily. Many use friendship as a way to mask aggressive desires. They come close to you to do more harm. A friend knows best how to hurt you. Or, without actually being friends, they offer assistance and alliance. They may seem supportive, but in the end, they're advancing their own interests at your expense. Then there are those who master moral warfare, playing the victim, making you feel guilty for something unspecified you'd done. The battlefield is full of these warriors, slippery, evasive, and clever. Understand, the word enemy, from the Latin inimicus, not a friend, has been demonized and politicized. Your first task as a strategist is to widen your concept of the enemy, to include in that group those who are working against you, thwarting you, even in subtle ways. Sometimes indifference and neglect are better weapons than aggression because you can't see the hostility they hide. Without getting paranoid, you need to realize that there are people who wish you ill and operate indirectly. Identify them, and you'll suddenly have room to maneuver. You can stand back and wait and see, or you can take action, whether aggressive or just evasive, to avoid the worst. You can even work to turn this enemy into a friend. But whatever you do, do not be the naive victim. Do not find yourself constantly retreating, reacting to your enemy's maneuvers. Arm yourself with prudence, and never completely lay down your arms, not even for friends. People are usually good at hiding their hostility, but often they unconsciously give off signals showing that all is not what it seems. One of the closest friends and advisors of the Chinese Communist Party leader Mao Zedong was Lin Biao, a high-ranking member of the Politburo and possible successor to the chairman. In the late 1960s and early 70s, though, Mao detected a change in Lin. He had become effusively friendly. Everyone praised Mao, but Lin's praise was embarrassingly fervent. To Mao, this meant that something was wrong. He watched Lin closely and decided that the man was plotting a takeover, or at the very least, positioning himself for the top spot. And Mao was right. Lin was plotting busily. The point is not to mistrust all friendly gestures, but to notice them. Register any change in the emotional temperature. Unusual chumminess, a new desire to exchange confidences, excessive praise of you to third parties, the desire for an alliance that may make more sense for the other person than for you. Trust your instincts. If someone's behavior seems suspicious, it probably is. It may turn out to be benign, but in the meantime, it is best to be on your guard. You can sit back and read the signs, or you can actively work to uncover your enemies. Beat the grass to startle the snakes, as the Chinese say. In the Bible, we read of David's suspicion that his father-in-law, King Saul, secretly wanted him dead. How could David find out? He confided his suspicion to Saul's son, Jonathan, his close friend. Jonathan refused to believe it, so David suggested a test. He was expected at court for a feast. He would not go. Jonathan would attend and pass along David's excuse, which would be adequate but not urgent. Sure enough, the excuse enraged Saul, who exclaimed, "Send at once and fetch him unto me. He deserves to die." David's test succeeded because it was ambiguous. His excuse for missing the feast could be read in more than one way. If Saul meant well toward David, he would have seen his son-in-law's absence as no more than selfish at worst. But because he secretly hated David, he saw it as effrontery, and it pushed him over the edge. Follow David's example. Say or do something that can be read in more than one way, that may be superficially polite, but that could also indicate a slight coolness on your part, or be seen as a subtle insult. A friend may wonder, but will let it pass. The secret enemy, though, will react with anger. Any strong emotion, and you will know that there's something boiling under the surface. Often the best way to get people to reveal themselves is to provoke tension and argument. The Hollywood producer Harry Cohn, president of Universal Pictures, frequently used this strategy to ferret out the real position of people in the studio who refused to show what side they were on. He would suddenly attack their work or take an extreme position, even an offensive one, in an argument. His provoked directors and writers would drop their usual caution and show their real beliefs. Understand, people tend to be vague and slippery because it is safer than outwardly committing to something. If you are the boss, they will mimic your ideas. Their agreement is often pure courtiership. Get them emotional. People are usually more sincere when they argue. If you pick an argument with someone and he keeps on mimicking your ideas, you may be dealing with a chameleon, a particularly dangerous type. Beware of people who hide behind a facade of vague abstractions and impartiality. No one is impartial. A sharply worded question, an opinion designed to offend, will make them react and take sides. Sometimes it is better to take a less direct approach with your potential enemies, to be as subtle and conniving as they are. In 1519, Hernan Cortes arrived in Mexico with his band of adventurers. Among these 500 men were some whose loyalty was dubious. Throughout the expedition, whenever any of Cortes's soldiers did something he saw as suspicious, he never got angry or accusatory. Instead, he pretended to go along with them, accepting and approving what they had done. Thinking Cortes weak, or thinking he was on their side, they would take another step. Now he had what he wanted, a clear sign to himself and others that they were traitors. Now he could isolate and destroy them. Adopt the method of Cortes. If friends or followers whom you suspect of ulterior motives suggest something subtly hostile or against your interests or simply odd, avoid the temptation to react, to say no, to get angry, or even to ask questions. Go along, or seem to turn a blind eye. Your enemies will soon go further, showing more of their hand. Now you have them in sight, and you can attack. An enemy is often large and hard to pinpoint, an organization, or a person hidden behind some complicated network. What you want to do is take aim at one part of the group, a leader, a spokesman, a key member of the inner circle. That is how the activist Saul Alinsky tackled corporations and bureaucracies. In his 1960s campaign to desegregate Chicago's public school system, he focused on the superintendent of schools, knowing full well that this man would try to shift the blame upward. By taking repeated hits at the superintendent, he was able to publicize his struggle, and it became impossible for the man to hide. Eventually, those behind him had to come to his aid, exposing themselves in the process. Like Alinsky, never aim at a vague, abstract enemy. It is hard to drum up the emotions to fight such a bloodless battle, which in any case leaves your enemy invisible. Personalize the fight, eyeball to eyeball. Danger is everywhere. There are always hostile people and destructive relationships. The only way to break out of a negative dynamic is to confront it. Repressing your anger, avoiding the person threatening you, always looking to conciliate, these common strategies spell ruin. Avoidance of conflict becomes a habit, and you lose the taste for battle. Feeling guilty is pointless. It is not your fault you have enemies. Feeling wronged or victimized is equally futile. In both cases, you are looking inward, concentrating on yourself and your feelings. Instead of internalizing a bad situation, externalize it and face your enemy. It is the only way out. The child psychologist Jean Piaget saw conflict as a critical part of mental development. Through battles with peers and then parents, children learn to adapt to the world and develop strategies for dealing with problems. Those children who seek to avoid conflict at all cost, or those who have overprotective parents, end up handicapped socially and mentally. The same is true of adults. It is through your battles with others that you learn what works, what doesn't, and how to protect yourself. Instead of shrinking from the idea of having enemies, then embrace it. Conflict is therapeutic. Enemies bring many gifts. For one thing, they motivate you and focus your beliefs. The artist Salvador Dali found early on that there were many qualities he could not stand in people: conformity, romanticism, piety. At every stage of his life, he found someone he thought embodied these anti-ideals, an enemy to vent on. First, it was the poet Federico Garcia Lorca, who wrote romantic poetry. Then it was André Breton, the heavy-handed leader of the Surrealist movement. Having such enemies to rebel against made Dali feel confident and inspired. Enemies also give you a standard by which to judge yourself, both personally and socially. The samurai of Japan had no gauge of their excellence unless they fought the best swordsmen. It took Joe Frazier to make Muhammad Ali a truly great fighter. A tough opponent will bring out the best in you. And the bigger the opponent, the greater your reward, even in defeat. It is better to lose to a worthy opponent than to squash some harmless foe. You will gain sympathy and respect, building support for your next fight. Being attacked is a sign that you are important enough to be a target. You should relish the attention and the chance to prove yourself. We all have aggressive impulses that we are forced to repress. An enemy supplies you with an outlet for these drives. At last, you have someone on whom to unleash your aggression without feeling guilty. Leaders have always found it useful to have an enemy at their gates in times of trouble, distracting the public from their difficulties. In using your enemies to rally your troops, polarize them as far as possible. They will fight the more fiercely when they feel a little hatred. So exaggerate the differences between you and the enemy. Draw the lines clearly. Xenophon made no effort to be fair. He did not say that the Persians weren't really such a bad lot and had done much to advance civilization. He called them barbarians, the antithesis of the Greeks. He described their recent treachery and said they were an evil culture that could find no favor with the gods. And so it is with you. Victory is your goal, not fairness and balance. Use the rhetoric of war to heighten the stakes and stimulate the spirit. What you want in warfare is room to maneuver. Tight corners spell death. Having enemies gives you options. You can play them off against each other, make one a friend as a way of attacking the other, on and on. Without enemies, you will not know how or where to maneuver, and you will lose a sense of your limits, of how far you can go. Early on, Julius Caesar identified Pompey as his enemy. Measuring his actions and calculating carefully, he did only those things that left him in a solid position in relation to Pompey. When war finally broke out between the two men, Caesar was at his best. But once he defeated Pompey and had no more such rivals, he lost all sense of proportion. In fact, he fancied himself a god. His defeat of Pompey was his own undoing. Your enemies force on you a sense of realism and humility. Remember, there are always people out there who are more aggressive, more devious, more ruthless than you are, and it is inevitable that some of them will cross your path. You will have a tendency to want to conciliate and compromise with them, The reason is that such types are often brilliant deceivers who see the strategic value in charm or in seeming to allow you plenty of space, but actually their desires have no limit and they are simply trying to disarm you. With some people, you have to harden yourself to recognize that there is no middle ground, no hope of conciliation. For your opponent, your desire to compromise is a weapon to use against you. Know these dangerous enemies by their past. Look for quick power grabs, sudden rises in fortune, previous acts of treachery. Once you suspect you are dealing with a Napoleon, do not lay down your arms or entrust them to someone else. You are the last line of your own defense. Reversal. Always keep the search for and use of enemies under control. It is clarity you want, not paranoia. It is the downfall of many tyrants to see an enemy in everyone. They lose their grip on reality and become hopelessly embroiled in the emotions their paranoia churns up. By keeping an eye on possible enemies, you are simply being prudent and cautious. Keep your suspicions to yourself, so that if you're wrong, no one will know. Also, beware of polarizing people so completely that you cannot back off. Margaret Thatcher, usually brilliant at the polarizing game, eventually lost control of it. She created too many enemies and kept repeating the same tactic, even in situations that called for retreat. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was a master polarizer, always looking to draw a line between himself and his enemies. Once he had made that line clear enough, though, he backed off, which made him look like a conciliator, a man of peace, who occasionally went to war. Even if that impression was false, it was the height of wisdom to create it. Here are further reflections on the strategy of polarity. From Anabasis, The March Up Country, by Xenophon. Then Xenophon got up and first called together the under-officers of Proxenus. When they were collected, he said, "Gentlemen, I cannot sleep, and I don't think you can. And I can't lie here when I see what a plight we are in. It is clear that the enemy did not show us open war until they thought they had everything well prepared, and no one among us takes the pains to make the best possible resistance. Yet if we give way and fall into the king's power, what do we expect our fate will be? When his own half-brother was dead, the man cut off his head and cut off his hand and stuck them up on a pole. We have no one to plead for us, and we marched here to make the king a slave or to kill him if we could, and what do you think our fate will be? Would he not go to all extremes of torture to make the whole world afraid of making war on him? Why, we must do anything to keep out of his power. While the truce lasted, I never ceased pitying ourselves. I never ceased congratulating the king and his army. What a vast country I saw! How large! What endless provisions! What crowds of servants! How many cattle and sheep! What gold! What raiment! But when I thought of these our soldiers, we had no share in all these good things unless we bought them, and few had anything left to buy with. And to procure anything without buying was debarred by our oaths. While I reasoned like this, I sometimes feared the truce more than the war now. However, now they have broken the truce, there is an end both to their insolence and to our suspicion. There lie all these good things before us, prizes for whichever side prove the better men. The gods are the judges of the contest, and they will be with us naturally. When you have appointed as many commanders as are wanted, assemble all the other soldiers and encourage them. That will be just what they want now. Perhaps you have noticed yourselves how crestfallen they were when they came into camp, how crestfallen they went on guard. In such a state, I don't know what you could do with them, but if someone could turn their minds from wondering what will happen to them and make them wonder what they could do, they will be much more cheerful. You know, I am sure that not numbers or strength brings victory in war. But whichever army goes into battle stronger in soul, their enemies generally cannot withstand them. by Carl Schmitt. Political thought and political instinct prove themselves theoretically and practically in the ability to distinguish friend and enemy. The high points of politics are simultaneously the moments in which the enemy is, in concrete clarity, recognized as the enemy. By Friedrich Nietzsche. I am by nature warlike. To attack is among my instincts. To be able to be an enemy, to be an enemy, that presupposes a strong nature. It is in any event a condition of every strong nature. It needs resistances. Consequently, it seeks resistances. The strength of one who attacks has in the opposition he needs a kind of gauge. Every growth reveals itself in the seeking out of a powerful opponent or problem. For a philosopher who is warlike also challenges problems to a duel. The undertaking is to master not any resistances that happen to present themselves, but those against which one has to bring all one's strength, suppleness, and mastery of weapons, to master equal opponents. From The Persistence of Memory, A Biography of Dali, by Meredith Etherington Smith. Salvador Dali had no time for those who did not agree with his principles, and took the war into the enemy camp by writing insulting letters to many of the friends he had made in the Residencia, calling them pigs. He happily compared himself to a clever bull, avoiding the cowboys, and generally had a great deal of fun stirring up and scandalizing almost every Catalan intellectual worthy of the name. Dali was beginning to burn his bridges with the zeal of an arsonist. We, Dali and the filmmaker Luis Buñuel, had resolved to send a poisoned pen letter to one of the great celebrities of Spain, Dali later told his biographer Alain Bousquet. Our goal was pure subversion. Both of us were strongly influenced by Nietzsche. We hit upon two names, Manuel de Falla, the composer, and Juan Ramón Jiménez, the poet. We drew straws and Jiménez won. So we composed a frenzied and nasty letter of incomparable violence and addressed it to Juan Ramón Jiménez. It read, Our distinguished friend, we believe it is our duty to inform you, disinterestedly, that your work is deeply repugnant to us because of its immorality, its hysteria, its arbitrary quality. It caused Jiménez great pain. By Georg Simmel. The opposition of a member to an associate is no purely negative social factor, if only because such opposition is often the only means for making life with actually unbearable people at least possible. If we did not even have the power and the right to rebel against tyranny, arbitrariness, moodiness, tactlessness, we could not bear to have any relation to people from whose characters we thus suffer. We would feel pushed to take desperate steps, and these, indeed, would end the relation, but do not perhaps constitute conflict. Not only because of the fact that oppression usually increases if it is suffered calmly and without protest, but also because opposition gives us inner satisfaction, distraction, relief. Our opposition makes us feel that we are not completely victims of the circumstances. By William McDougall. As one travels up any one of the large rivers of Borneo, one meets with tribes that are successively more warlike. In the coast regions are peaceful communities, which never fight save in self-defense, and then with but poor success. Whereas in the central regions, where the rivers take their rise, are a number of extremely warlike tribes whose raids have been a constant source of terror to the communities settled in the lower reaches of the rivers. It might be supposed that the peaceful coast people would be found to be superior in moral qualities to their more warlike neighbors, but the contrary is the case. In almost all respects, the advantage lies with the warlike tribes. Their houses are better built, larger, and cleaner. Their domestic morality is superior. They are physically stronger, are braver, and physically and mentally more active, and in general are more trustworthy. But above all, Their social organization is firmer and more efficient, because their respect for and obedience to their chiefs and their loyalty to their community are much greater. Each man identifies himself with the whole community and accepts and loyally performs the social duties laid upon him. By Georg Hegel. Man exists only insofar as he is opposed. And lastly, from My Bondage and My Freedom by Frederick Douglass. The frequent hearing of my mistress reading the Bible, for she often read aloud when her husband was absent, soon awakened my curiosity in respect to this mystery of reading, and roused in me the desire to learn. Having no fear of my kind mistress before my eyes, she had given me no reason to fear, I frankly asked her to teach me to read. And without hesitation, the dear woman began the task, and very soon, by her assistance, I was master of the alphabet and could spell words of 3 or 4 letters. Master Hugh was amazed at the simplicity of his spouse, and probably for the first time, he unfolded to her the true philosophy of slavery and the peculiar rules necessary to be observed by masters and mistresses in the management of their human chattels. Mr. Auld promptly forbade the continuance of her reading instruction, telling her, in the first place, that the thing itself was unlawful, that it was also unsafe, and could only lead to mischief. Mrs. Auld evidently felt the force of his remarks, and, like an obedient wife, began to shape her course in the direction indicated by her husband. The effect of his words on me was neither slight nor transitory. His iron sentences, cold and harsh, sunk deep into my heart, and stirred up not only my feelings into a sort of rebellion, but awakened within me a slumbering train of vital thought. It was a new and special revelation, dispelling a painful mystery against which my youthful understanding had struggled, and struggled in vain, to wit, the white man's power to perpetuate the enslavement of the black man. Very well, thought I, knowledge unfits a child to be a slave. I instinctively assented to the proposition, and from that moment I understood the direct pathway from slavery to freedom. This was just what I needed, and got it at a time and from a source whence I least expected it. Wise as Mr. Auld was, he evidently underrated my comprehension, and had little idea of the use to which I was capable of putting the impressive lesson he was giving to his wife. That which he most loved, I most hated, and the very determination which he expressed to keep me in ignorance only rendered me the more resolute in seeking intelligence. Chapter 2. Do not fight the last war. The guerrilla war of the mind strategy. What most often weighs you down and brings you misery is the past, in the form of unnecessary attachments, repetitions of tired formulas, and the memory of old victories and defeats. You must consciously wage war against the past and force yourself to react to the present moment. Be ruthless on yourself. Do not repeat the same tired methods. Sometimes you must force yourself to strike out in new directions, even if they involve risk. What you may lose in comfort and security, you will gain in surprise, making it harder for your enemies to tell what you will do. Wage guerrilla war on your mind, allowing no static lines of defense, no exposed citadels. Make everything fluid and mobile. The Last War. No one has risen to power faster than Napoleon Bonaparte, 1769 to 1821. In 1793, he went from captain in the French Revolutionary Army to brigadier general. In 1796, he became the leader of the French force in Italy fighting the Austrians, whom he crushed that year and again 3 years later. He became first consul of France in 1801, emperor in 1804. In 1805, he humiliated the Austrian and Russian armies at the Battle of Austerlitz. For many, Napoleon was more than a great general. He was a genius, a god of war. Not everyone was impressed, though. There were Prussian generals who thought he had merely been lucky. Where Napoleon was rash and aggressive, they believed, his opponents had been timid and weak. If he ever faced the Prussians, he would be revealed as a great fake. Among these Prussian generals was Friedrich Ludwig, Prince of Hohenlohe-Ingelfingen, 1746 to 1818. Hohenlohe came from one of Germany's oldest aristocratic families, one with an illustrious military record. He had begun his career young, serving under Frederick the Great, 1712 to 86, himself, the man who had single-handedly made Prussia a great power. Hohenlohe had risen through the ranks, becoming a general at 50, young by Prussian standards. To Hohenlohe, success in war depended on organization, discipline, and the use of superior strategies developed by trained military minds. The Prussians exemplified all of these virtues. Prussian soldiers drilled relentlessly until they could perform elaborate maneuvers as precisely as a machine. Prussian generals intensely studied the victories of Frederick the Great. War, for them, was a mathematical affair, the application of timeless principles. To the generals, Napoleon was a Corsican hothead leading an unruly citizen's army. Superior in knowledge and skill, they would out-strategize him. The French would panic and crumble in the face of the disciplined Prussians. The Napoleonic myth would lie in ruins, and Europe could return to its old ways. In August 1806, Hohenlohe and his fellow generals finally got what they wanted. King Friedrich Wilhelm III of Prussia, tired of Napoleon's broken promises, decided to declare war on him in 6 weeks. In the meantime, he asked his generals to come up with a plan to crush the French. Hohenlohe was ecstatic. This campaign would be the climax of his career. He had been thinking for years about how to beat Napoleon, and he presented his plan at the general's first strategy session. Precise marches would place the army at the perfect angle from which to attack the French as they advanced through southern Prussia. An attack in oblique formation, Frederick the Great's favorite tactic, would deliver a devastating blow. The other generals, all in their 60s and 70s, presented their own plans, but these too were merely variants on the tactics of Frederick the Great. Discussion turned into argument. Several weeks went by. Finally, the king had to step in and create a compromise strategy that would satisfy all of his generals. A feeling of exuberance swept the country, which would soon relive the glory years of Frederick the Great. The generals realized that Napoleon knew about their plans. He had excellent spies. But the Prussians had a head start, and once their war machine started to move, nothing could stop it. On October 5th, a few days before the king was to declare war, disturbing news reached the generals. A reconnaissance mission revealed that divisions of Napoleon's army, which they had believed was dispersed, had marched east, merged, and was massing deep in southern Prussia. The captain who had led the scouting mission reported that the French soldiers were marching with packs on their backs. Where the Prussians used slow-moving wagons to provision their troops, the French carried their own supplies and moved with astonishing speed and mobility. Before the generals had time to adjust their plans, Napoleon's army suddenly wheeled north, heading straight for Berlin, the heart of Prussia. The generals argued and dithered, moving their troops here and there, trying to decide where to attack. A mood of panic set in. Finally, the king ordered a retreat. The troops would reassemble to the north and attack Napoleon's flank as he advanced toward Berlin. Hohenlohe was in charge of the rear guard, protecting the Prussians' retreat. On October 14th, near the town of Jena, Napoleon caught up with Hohenlohe, who finally faced the battle he had wanted so desperately. The numbers on both sides were equal, but while the French were an unruly force, fighting pell-mell and on the run, Hohenlohe kept his troops in tight order, orchestrating them like a corps de ballet. The fighting went back and forth, until finally the French captured the village of Fiertz and Heiligen. Hohenlohe ordered his troops to retake the village. In a ritual dating back to Frederick the Great, a drum major beat out a cadence, and the Prussian soldiers, their colors flying, reformed their positions in perfect parade order, preparing to advance. They were in an open plain, though, and Napoleon's men were behind garden walls and on the house roofs. The Prussians fell like ninepins to the French marksmen. Confused, Hohenlohe ordered his soldiers to halt and change formation. The drums beat again. The Prussians marched with magnificent precision, always a sight to behold. But the French kept shooting, decimating the Prussian line. Never had Hohenlohe seen such an army. The French soldiers were like demons. Unlike his disciplined soldiers, they moved on their own. Yet there was method to their madness. Suddenly, as if from nowhere, they rushed forward on both sides, threatening to surround the Prussians. The prince ordered a retreat. The Battle of Jena was over. Like a house of cards, the Prussians quickly crumbled, one fortress falling after another. The king fled east. In a matter of days, virtually nothing remained of the once mighty Prussian army. Interpretation. The reality facing the Prussians in 1806 was simple. They had fallen 50 years behind the times. Their generals were old, and instead of responding to present circumstances, they were repeating formulas that had worked in the past. Their army moved slowly, and their soldiers were automatons on parade. The Prussian generals had many signs to warn them of disaster. Their army had not performed well in its recent engagements. A number of Prussian officers had preached reform. And last but not least, they had had 10 years to study Napoleon. His innovative strategies, and the speed and fluidity with which his armies converged on the enemy. Reality was staring them in the face, yet they chose to ignore it. Indeed, they told themselves that Napoleon was the one who was doomed. You might find the Prussian army just an interesting historical example, but in fact, you are likely marching in the same direction yourself. What limits individuals as well as nations is the inability to confront reality, to see things for what they are. As we grow older, we become more rooted in the past. Habit takes over. Something that has worked for us before becomes a doctrine, a shell to protect us from reality. Repetition replaces creativity. We rarely realize we're doing this because it is almost impossible for us to see it happening in our own minds. Then, suddenly, a young Napoleon crosses our path, a person who does not respect tradition, who fights in a new way. Only then do we see that our ways of thinking and responding have fallen behind the times. Never take it for granted that your past successes will continue into the future. Actually, your past successes are your biggest obstacle. Every battle, every war, is different. And you cannot assume that what worked before will work today. You must cut yourself loose from the past and open your eyes to the present. Your tendency to fight the last war may lead to your final war. From On War by Karl von Clausewitz. When in 1806 the Prussian generals plunged into the open jaws of disaster by using Frederick the Great's oblique order of battle, it was not just a case of a style that had outlived its usefulness, but the most extreme poverty of the imagination to which routine has ever led. The result was that the Prussian army, under Hohenlohe, was ruined more completely than any army has ever been ruined on the battlefield. The present war. In 1605, Miyamoto Musashi, a samurai who had made a name for himself as a swordsman at the young age of 21, was challenged to a duel. The challenger, a young man named Matashichiro, came from the Yoshioka family, a clan itself renowned for swordsmanship. Earlier that year, Musashi had defeated Matashichiro's father, Genzaimon, in a duel. Days later, he had killed Genzaimon's younger brother in another duel. The Yoshioka family wanted revenge. Musashi's friends smelled a trap in Matashichiro's challenge and offered to accompany him to the duel, but Musashi went alone. In his earlier fights with the Yoshiokas, he had angered them by showing up hours late. This time, though, he came early and hid in the trees. Matashichiro arrived with a small army. Musashi would arrive way behind schedule as usual, one of them said, but that trick won't work with us anymore. Confident in their ambush, Matashichiro's men lay down and hid in the grass. Suddenly, Musashi leaped out from behind his tree and shouted, "I've been waiting long enough. Draw your sword." In one swift stroke, he killed Matashichiro, then took a position at an angle to the other men. All of them jumped to their feet, but they were caught off guard and startled, and instead of surrounding him, they stood in a broken line. Musashi simply ran down the line, killing the dazed men one after another in a matter of seconds. Musashi's victory sealed his reputation as one of Japan's greatest swordsmen. He now roamed the country looking for suitable challenges. In one town, he heard of an undefeated warrior named Baiken, whose weapons were a sickle and a long chain with a steel ball at the end of it. Musashi wanted to see these weapons in action, but Baiken refused. The only way he could see them work, Baiken said, was by fighting a duel. Once again, Musashi's friends chose the safe route. They urged him to walk away. No one had come close to defeating Baiken, whose weapons were unbeatable. Swinging his ball in the air to build up momentum, he would force his victim backward with a relentless charge, then hurl the ball at the man's face. His opponent would have to fend off the ball and chain, and while his sword arm was occupied, in that brief instant, Baiken would slash him with the sickle across his neck. Ignoring the warnings of his friends, Musashi challenged Baiken and showed up at the man's tent with two swords, one long, one short. Baiken had never seen someone fight with two swords. Also, instead of letting Baiken charge him, Musashi charged first, pushing his foe back on his heels. Baiken hesitated to throw the ball, for Musashi could parry it with one sword and strike him with the other. As he looked for an opening, Musashi suddenly knocked him off balance with a blow of the short sword and then in a split second followed with a thrust of the long one, stabbing him through and killing the once undefeated master Baiken. A few years later, Musashi heard about a great samurai named Sasaki Ganryu, who fought with a very long sword, a startlingly beautiful weapon which seemed possessed of some warlike spirit. This fight would be Musashi's ultimate test. Ganryu accepted his challenge. The duel would take place on a little island near the samurai's home. On the morning of the duel, the island was packed. A fight between such warriors was unprecedented. Ganryu arrived on time, but Musashi was late. Very late. An hour went by. Then two. Ganryu was furious. Finally, a boat was spotted approaching the island. Its passenger was lying down, half asleep, it seemed, whittling at a long wooden oar. It was Musashi. He seemed lost in thought, staring into the clouds. When the boat came to shore, he tied a dirty towel around his head and jumped out of the boat, brandishing the long oar, longer than Gunryu's famous sword. This strange man had come to the biggest fight of his life with an oar for a sword and a towel for a headband. Ganryu called out angrily, "Are you so frightened of me that you have broken your promise to be here by 8? Musashi said nothing, but stepped closer. Ganryu drew his magnificent sword and threw the sheath onto the sand. Musashi smiled. "Sasaki, you have just sealed your doom." "Me? Defeated? Impossible." "What victor on earth," replied Musashi, "would abandon his sheath to the sea?" This enigmatic remark only made Ganryu angrier. Then Musashi charged, aiming his sharpened oar straight for his enemy's eyes. Gunryu quickly raised his sword and struck at Musashi's head, but missed, only cutting the towel headband in two. He had never missed before. In almost the same instant, Musashi brought down his wooden sword, knocking Gunryu off his feet. The spectators gasped. As Gunryu struggled up, Musashi killed him with a blow to the head. Then, after bowing politely to the men officiating over the duel, he got back into the boat and left as calmly as he had arrived. From that moment on, Musashi was considered a swordsman without peer. Interpretation. Miyamoto Musashi, author of The Book of Five Rings, won all his duels for one reason. In each instance, he adapted his strategy to his opponent and to the circumstances of the moment. With Matashichiro, he decided it was time to arrive early, which he hadn't done in his previous fights. Victory against superior numbers depended on surprise, so he leaped up when his opponents lay down. Then, once he had killed their leader, he set himself at an angle that invited them to charge at him instead of surrounding him, which would have been much more dangerous for him. With Baiken, it was simply a matter of using two swords and then crowding his space, giving him no time to react intelligently to this novelty. With Gunryu, he set out to infuriate and humiliate his haughty opponent. The wooden sword, the nonchalant attitude, the dirty towel headband, the enigmatic remark, the charge at the eyes. Musashi's opponents depended on brilliant technique, flashy swords, and unorthodox weapons. That is the same as fighting the last war. Instead of responding to the moment, they relied on training, technology, and what had worked before. Musashi, who had grasped the essence of strategy when he was still very young, turned their rigidity into their downfall. His first thought was of the gambit that would take this particular opponent most by surprise. Then he would anchor himself in the moment. Having set his opponent off balance with something unexpected, he would watch carefully, then respond with another action, usually improvised, that would turn mere disequilibrium into defeat and death. In preparing yourself for war, you must rid yourself of myths and misconceptions. Strategy is not a question of learning a series of moves or ideas to follow like a recipe. Victory has no magic formula. Ideas are merely nutrients for the soil. They lie in your brain as possibilities, so that in the heat of the moment, they can inspire a direction, an appropriate and creative response. Let go of all fetishes, books, techniques, formulas, flashy weapons, and learn to become your own strategist. By Sun-Tzu. Thus one's victories in battle cannot be repeated. They take their form in response to inexhaustibly changing circumstances. Keys to Warfare. In looking back on an unpleasant or disagreeable experience, the thought inevitably occurs to us, if only we had said or done X instead of Y, if only we could do it over. Many a general has lost his head in the heat of battle, and then looking back, has thought of the one tactic, the one maneuver that would have changed it all. Even Prince Hohenlohe, years later, could see how he had botched the retaking of Viertzehn-Heiligen. The problem, though, is not that we think of the solution only when it is too late. The problem is that we imagine that knowledge is what was lacking. If only we had known more. If only we had thought it through more thoroughly. That is precisely the wrong approach. What makes us go astray in the first place is that we are unattuned to the present moment, insensitive to the circumstances. We are listening to our own thoughts, reacting to things that happened in the past, applying theories and ideas that we digested long ago, but that have nothing to do with our predicament in the present. More books, theories, and thinking only make the problem worse. Understand, the greatest generals, the most creative strategists, stand out not because they have more knowledge, but because they are able, when necessary, to drop their preconceived notions and focus intensely on the present moment. That is how creativity is sparked and opportunities are seized. Knowledge, experience, and theory have limitations. No amount of thinking in advance can prepare you for the chaos of life, for the infinite possibilities of the moment. The great philosopher of war, Karl von Clausewitz, called this friction, the difference between our plans and what actually happens. Since friction is inevitable, our minds have to be capable of keeping up with change and adapting to the unexpected. The better we can adapt our thoughts to changing circumstances, the more realistic our responses to them will be. The more we lose ourselves in predigested theories and past experiences, the more inappropriate and delusional our response. It can be valuable to analyze what went wrong in the past, but it is far more important to develop the capacity to think in the moment. In that way, you will make far fewer mistakes to analyze. Think of the mind as a river. The faster it flows, the better it keeps up with the present and responds to change. The faster it flows, also the more it refreshes itself, and the greater its energy. Obsessional thoughts, past experiences, whether traumas or successes, and preconceived notions are like boulders or mud in this river, settling and hardening there and damming it up. The river stops moving. Stagnation sets in. You must wage constant war on this tendency in the mind. The first step is simply to be aware of the process and of the need to fight it. The second is to adopt a few tactics that might help you to restore the mind's natural flow. Re-examine all your cherished beliefs and principles. When Napoleon was asked what principles of war he followed, he replied that he followed none. His genius was his ability to respond to circumstances, to make the most of what he was given. He was the supreme opportunist. Your only principle, similarly, should be to have no principles. To believe that strategy has inexorable laws or timeless rules is to take up a rigid, static position that will be your undoing. Of course, the study of history and theory can broaden your vision of the world, but you have to combat theory's tendency to harden into dogma. Be brutal with the past, with tradition, with the old ways of doing things. Declare war on sacred cows and voices of convention in your own head. Our education is often a problem. During World War II, the British fighting the Germans in the deserts of North Africa were well trained in tank warfare. You might say they were indoctrinated with theories about it. Later in the campaign, they were joined by American troops who were much less educated in these tactics. Soon, though, the Americans began to fight in a way that was equal, if not superior, to the British style. They adapted to the mobility of this new kind of desert combat. According to Field Marshal Erwin Rommel himself, the leader of the German army in North Africa, the Americans profited far more than the British from their experience in Africa, thus confirming the axiom that education is easier than re-education. What Rommel meant was that education tends to burn precepts into the mind that are hard to shake. In the midst of combat, the trained mind may fall a step behind, focusing more on learned rules than on the changing circumstances of battle. When you are faced with a new situation, it is often best to imagine that you know nothing and that you need to start learning all over again, clearing your head of everything you thought you knew, even your most cherished ideas, will give you the mental space to be educated by your present experience, the best school of all. You will develop your own strategic muscles instead of depending on other people's theories and books. Erase the memory of the last war. The last war you fought is a danger, even if you won it. It is fresh in your mind. If you were victorious, you will tend to repeat the strategies you just used, for success makes us lazy and complacent. If you lost, you may be skittish and indecisive. Do not think about the last war. You do not have the distance or the detachment. Instead, do whatever you can to blot it from your mind. During the Vietnam War, the great North Vietnamese general, Vo Nguyen Giáp, had a simple rule of thumb. After a successful campaign, he would convince himself that it had actually been a failure. As a result, he never got drunk on his success, and he never repeated the same strategy in the next battle. Rather, he had to think through each situation anew. Ted Williams, perhaps baseball's greatest pure hitter, made a point of always trying to forget his last at-bat. Whether he'd gotten a home run or a strikeout, he put it behind him. No two at-bats are the same, even against the same pitcher, and Williams wanted an open mind. He would not wait for the next at-bat to start forgetting. The minute he got back to the dugout, he started focusing on what was happening in the game taking place. Attention to the details of the present is by far the best way to crowd out the past and forget the last war. Keep the mind moving. When we were children, our minds never stopped. We were open to new experiences and absorbed as much of them as possible. We learned fast because the world around us excited us. When we felt frustrated or upset, we would find some creative way to get what we wanted and then quickly forget the problem as something new crossed our path. All the greatest strategists, Alexander the Great, Napoleon, Musashi, were childlike in this respect. Sometimes, in fact, they even acted like children. The reason is simple. Superior strategists see things as they are. They are highly sensitive to dangers and opportunities. Nothing stays the same in life, and keeping up with circumstances as they change requires a great deal of mental fluidity. Great strategists do not act according to preconceived ideas. They respond to the moment, like children. Their minds are always moving, and they are always excited and curious. They quickly forget the past. The present is much too interesting. The Greek thinker Aristotle thought that life was defined by movement. What does not move is dead. What has speed and mobility has more possibilities, more life. We all start off with the mobile mind of a Napoleon, but as we get older, we tend to become more like the Prussians. You may think that what you'd like to recapture from your youth is your looks, your physical fitness, your simple pleasures, but what you really need is the fluidity of mind you once possessed. Whenever you find your thoughts revolving around a particular subject or idea, an obsession, a resentment, force them past it. Distract yourself with something else. Like a child, find something new to be absorbed by, something worthy of concentrated attention. Do not waste time on things you cannot change or influence. Just keep moving. Absorb the spirit of the times. Throughout the history of warfare, there have been classic battles in which the past has confronted the future in a hopeless mismatch. It happened in the 7th century when the Persians and Byzantines confronted the invincible armies of Islam with their new form of desert fighting. Or in the first half of the 13th century, when the Mongols used relentless mobility to overwhelm the heavy armies of the Russians and Europeans. Or in 1806, when Napoleon crushed the Prussians at Jena. In each case, the conquering army developed a way of fighting that maximized a new form of technology or a new social order. You can reproduce this effect on a smaller scale by attuning yourself to the spirit of the times. Developing antennae for the trends that have yet to crest takes work and study, as well as the flexibility to adapt to those trends. As you get older, it is best to periodically alter your style. In the golden age of Hollywood, most actresses had very short careers, but Joan Crawford fought the studio system and managed to have a remarkably long career by constantly changing her style, going from siren to noir heroine to cult queen. Instead of staying sentimentally attached to some fashion of days gone by, she was able to sense a rising trend and go with it. By constantly adapting and changing your style, you will avoid the pitfalls of your previous wars. Just when people feel they know you, you will change. Reverse course. The great Russian novelist Fyodor Dostoevsky suffered from epilepsy. Just before a seizure, he would experience a moment of intense ecstasy, which he described as a feeling of being suddenly flooded with reality, a momentary vision of the world exactly as it is. Later, he would find himself getting depressed, as this vision was crowded out by the habits and routines of daily life. During these depressions, wanting to feel that closeness to reality again, he would go to the nearest casino and gamble away all his money. There, reality would overwhelm him. Comfort and routine would be gone, stale patterns broken. Having to rethink everything, he would get his creative energy back. This was the closest he could deliberately come to the sense of ecstasy he got through epilepsy. Dostoevsky's method was a little extreme, but sometimes you have to shake yourself up, break free from the hold of the past. This can take the form of reversing your course, doing the opposite of what you would normally do in any given situation, putting yourself in some unusual circumstance, or, literally, starting over. In those situations, the mind has to deal with a new reality and it snaps to life. The change may be alarming, but it is also refreshing, even exhilarating. Relationships often develop a certain tiresome predictability. You do what you usually do. Other people respond the way they usually do, and around it goes. If you reverse course, act in a novel manner, you alter the entire dynamic. Do this every so often to break up the relationship's stale patterns and open it to new possibilities. Think of your mind as an army. Armies must adapt to the complexity and chaos of modern war by becoming more fluid and maneuverable. The ultimate extension of this evolution is guerrilla warfare, which exploits chaos by making disorder and unpredictability a strategy. The guerrilla army never stops to defend a particular place or town. It wins by always moving, staying one step ahead. By following no set pattern, it gives the enemy no target. The guerrilla army never repeats the same tactic. It responds to the situation, the moment, the terrain where it happens to find itself. There is no front, no concrete line of communication or supply, no slow-moving wagon. The guerrilla army is pure mobility. That is the model for your new way of thinking. Apply no tactic rigidly. Do not let your mind settle into static positions, defending any particular place or idea, repeating the same lifeless maneuvers. Attack problems from new angles, adapting to the landscape and to what you're given. By staying in constant motion, you show your enemies no target to aim at. You exploit the chaos of the world instead of succumbing to it. Reversal. There is never any value in fighting the last war. But while you're eliminating that pernicious tendency, you must imagine that your enemy is trying to do the same, trying to learn from and adapt to the present. Some of history's worst military disasters have come not out of fighting the last war, but out of assuming that that's what your opponent will do. When Saddam Hussein of Iraq invaded Kuwait in 1990, he thought the United States had yet to recover from Vietnam syndrome, the fear of casualties and loss that had been so traumatic during the Vietnam period, and that it would either avoid war altogether or would fight in the same way it had, trying to win the fight from the air instead of on the ground. He did not realize that the American military was ready for a new kind of war. Remember, the loser in any battle may be too traumatized to fight again, but may also learn from the experience and move on. Err on the side of caution. Be ready. Never let your enemy surprise you in war. Here are further reflections on the strategy of guerrilla war of the mind. From On War by Carl von Clausewitz. Theory cannot equip the mind with formulas for solving problems, nor can it mark the narrow path on which the sole solution is supposed to lie by planting a hedge of principles on either side. But it can give the mind insight into the great mass of phenomena and of their relationships, then leave it free to rise into the higher realms of action. There the mind can use its innate talents to capacity, combining them all so as to seize on what is right and true, as though this were a single idea formed by their concentrated pressure, as though it were a response to the immediate challenge rather than a product of thought. By Friedrich von Bernardi. He, Baron Antoine-Henri de Jomini, often quite arbitrarily presses the deeds of Napoleon into a system which he foists on Napoleon, and in doing so completely fails to see what, above all, really constitutes the greatness of this captain, namely, the reckless boldness of his operations, where, scoffing at all theory, he always tried to do what suited each occasion best. From Aesop's Fables. The Bat and the House Ferrets. A bat fell to the ground and was caught by a house ferret. Realizing that she was on the point of being killed, she begged for her life. The house ferret said to her that she couldn't let her go, for ferrets were supposed to be natural enemies to all birds. The bat replied that she herself was not a bird, but a mouse. She managed to extricate herself from her danger by this means. Eventually, falling a second time, the bat was caught by another house ferret. Again, she pleaded to the ferret not to eat her. The second ferret declared that she absolutely detested all mice. But the bat positively affirmed that she was not a mouse, but a bat. And so she was released again. And that was how she saved herself from death twice by a mere change of name. This fable shows that it is not always necessary to confine ourselves to the same tactics. But on the contrary, if we are adaptable to circumstances, we can better escape danger. By Mao Zedong. I never read any treatises on strategy. When we fight, we do not take any books with us. From The Book of Five Rings by Miyamoto Musashi. Refreshing the mind. When you and your opponent are engaged in combat which is dragging on with no end in sight, it is crucial that you should come up with a completely different technique. By refreshing your mind and techniques as you continue to fight your opponent, you will find an appropriate rhythm timing with which to defeat him. Whenever you and your opponent become stagnant, you must immediately employ a different method of dealing with him in order to overcome him. From Takuan, Japan. It is a disease to be obsessed by the thought of winning. It is also a disease to be obsessed by the thought of employing your swordsmanship. So it is to be obsessed by the thought of using everything you have learned, and to be obsessed by the thought of attacking. It is also a disease to be obsessed and stuck with the thought of ridding yourself of any of these diseases. A disease here is an obsessed mind that dwells on one thing. Because all these diseases are in your mind, you must get rid of them to put your mind in order. By Napoleon Bonaparte. Anyone can plan a campaign, but few are capable of waging war, because only a true military genius can handle the developments and circumstances. From the I Ching, China. Thunder and wind, the image of duration. Thus the superior man stands firm and does not change his direction. Thunder rolls and the wind blows. Both are examples of extreme mobility, and so are seemingly the very opposite of duration, but the laws governing their appearance and subsidence, their coming and going, endure. In the same way, the independence of the superior man is not based on rigidity and immobility of character. He always keeps abreast of the time and changes with it. What endures is the unswerving directive, the inner law of his being, which determines all his actions. By Abraham Lincoln. My policy is to have no policy. From Takawan, Japan. If you put an empty gourd on the water and touch it, it will slip to one side. No matter how you try, it won't stay in one spot. The mind of someone who has reached the ultimate state does not stay with anything, even for a second. It is like an empty gourd on the water that is pushed around. Defeat into Victory by William Slim. Defeat is bitter. Bitter to the common soldier, but trebly bitter to his general. The soldier may comfort himself with the thought that, whatever the result, he has done his duty faithfully and steadfastly, but the commander has failed in his duty if he has not won victory, for that is his duty. He has no other comparable to it. He will go over in his mind the events of the campaign. Here, he will think, I went wrong. Here I took counsel of my fears when I should have been bold. There I should have waited to gather strength, not struck piecemeal. At such a moment I failed to grasp opportunity when it was presented to me. He will remember the soldiers whom he sent into the attack that failed and who did not come back. He will recall the look in the eyes of men who trusted him. I have failed them, he will say to himself, and failed my country. He will see himself for what he is, a defeated general. In a dark hour he will turn in upon himself and question the very foundations of his leadership and manhood. And then he must stop. For if he is ever to command in battle again, he must shake off these regrets and stamp on them, as they claw at his will and his self-confidence. He must beat off these attacks he delivers against himself, and cast out the doubts born of failure. Forget them, and remember only the lessons to be learned from defeat. They are more than from victory. And lastly, by Jiddu Krishnamurti. To know that one is in a certain condition, in a certain state, is already a process of liberation. But a man who is not aware of his condition, of his struggle, tries to be something other than he is, which brings about habit. So then, let us keep in mind that we want to examine what is, to observe, and be aware of exactly what is the actual, without giving it any slant, without giving it an interpretation. It needs an extraordinarily astute mind, an extraordinarily pliable heart, to be aware of and to follow what is, because what is constantly moving, constantly undergoing a transformation. And if the mind is tethered to belief, to knowledge, it ceases to pursue. It ceases to follow the swift movement of what is. What is not static, surely. It is constantly moving, as you will see if you observe it very closely. To follow it, you need a very swift mind and a pliable heart, which are denied when the mind is static, fixed in a belief, in a prejudice, in an identification. And a mind and heart that are dry cannot follow easily, swiftly, that which is. Chapter 3. Amidst the turmoil of events, do not lose your presence of mind. The counterbalance strategy. In the heat of battle, the mind tends to lose its balance. Too many things confront you at the same time: unexpected setbacks, doubts and criticisms from your own allies. There's a danger of responding emotionally with fear, depression, or frustration. It is vital to keep your presence of mind, maintaining your mental powers, whatever the circumstances. You must actively resist the emotional pull of the moment, staying decisive, confident, and aggressive no matter what hits you. Make the mind tougher by exposing it to adversity. Learn to detach yourself from the chaos of the battlefield. Let others lose their heads. Your presence of mind will steer you clear of their influence and keep you on course. The hyper-aggressive tactic. Vice Admiral Lord Horatio Nelson, 1758 to 1805, had been through it all. He had lost his right eye in the siege of Calvi and his right arm in the Battle of Tenerife. He had defeated the Spanish at Cape St. Vincent in 1797 and had thwarted Napoleon's Egyptian campaign by defeating his navy at the Battle of the Nile the following year. But none of his tribulations and triumphs prepared him for the problems he faced from his own colleagues in the British Navy as they prepared to go to war against Denmark in February 1801. Nelson, England's most glorious war hero, was the obvious choice to lead the fleet. Instead, the Admiralty chose Sir Hyde Parker, with Nelson his second in command. This war was a delicate business. It was intended to force the disobedient Danes to comply with a British-led embargo on the shipping of military goods to France. The fiery Nelson was prone to lose his cool. He hated Napoleon, and if he went too far against the Danes, he would produce a diplomatic fiasco. Sir Hyde was an older, more stable, even-tempered man who would do the job and nothing more. Nelson swallowed his pride and took the assignment, but he saw trouble ahead. He knew that time was of the essence. The faster the navy sailed, the less chance the Danes would have to build up their defenses. The ships were ready to sail, but Parker's motto was, "Everything in good order." It wasn't his style to hurry. Nelson hated his casualness and burned for action. He reviewed intelligence reports, studied maps, and came up with a detailed plan for fighting the Danes. He wrote to Parker, urging him to seize the initiative. Parker ignored him. At last, on March 11th, the British fleet set sail. Instead of heading for Copenhagen, however, Parker anchored well to the north of the city's harbor and called a meeting of his captains. According to intelligence reports, he explained, the Danes had prepared elaborate defenses for Copenhagen. Boats anchored in the harbor, forts to the north and south, and mobile artillery batteries could blast the British out of the water. How to fight this artillery without terrible losses? Also, pilots who knew the waters around Copenhagen reported that they were treacherous, places of sandbars and tricky winds. Navigating these dangers under bombardment would be harrowing. With all of these difficulties, perhaps it was best to wait for the Danes to leave harbor and then fight them in open sea. Nelson struggled to control himself. Finally, he let loose, pacing the room, the stub of his lost arm jerking as he spoke. No war, he said, had ever been won by waiting. The Danish defenses looked formidable to those who are children at war, but he had worked out a strategy weeks earlier. He would attack from the south, the easier approach, while Parker and a reserve force would stay to the city's north. Nelson would use his mobility to take out the Danish guns. He had studied the maps. Sandbars were no threat. As for the wind, aggressive action was more important than fretting over wind. Nelson's speech energized Parker's captains. He was by far their most successful leader, and his confidence was catching. Even Sir Hyde was impressed, and the plan was approved. The next morning, Nelson's line of ships advanced on Copenhagen, and the battle began. The Danish guns, firing on the British at close range, took a fierce toll. Nelson paced the deck of his flagship, HMS Elephant, urging his men on. He was in an excited, almost ecstatic state. A shot through the mainmast nearly hit him. "It is a warm work, and this day may be the last to any of us at any moment," he told a colonel, a little shaken up by the blast. "But mark you, I would not be elsewhere for thousands." Parker followed the battle from his position to the north. He now regretted agreeing to Nelson's plan. He was responsible for the campaign, and a defeat here could ruin his career. After 4 hours of back-and-forth bombardment, he had seen enough. The fleet had taken a beating and had gained no advantage. Nelson never knew when to quit. Parker decided it was time to hoist the signal flag 39, the order to withdraw. The first ships to see it were to acknowledge it and pass the signal on down the line. Once acknowledged, there was nothing else to do but retreat. The battle was over. On board the Elephant, a lieutenant told Nelson about the signal. The vice admiral ignored it. Continuing to pound the Danish defenses, he eventually called to an officer, "Is number 16 still hoisted?" Number 16 was his own flag. It meant engage the enemy more closely. The officer confirmed that the flag was still flying. "Mind you keep it so," Nelson told him. A few minutes later, Parker's signal still flapping in the breeze, Nelson turned to his flag captain. "You know, Foley, I have only one eye. I have a right to be blind sometimes." And raising his telescope to his blind eye, he calmly remarked, "I really do not see the signal." Torn between obeying Parker and obeying Nelson, the fleet captains chose Nelson. They would risk their careers along with his. But soon the Danish defenses started to crack. Some of the ships anchored in the harbor surrendered, and the firing of the guns began to slow. Less than an hour after Parker's signal to stop the battle, the Danes surrendered. The next day, Parker perfunctorily congratulated Nelson on the victory. He did not mention his subordinate's disobedience. He was hoping the whole affair, including his own lack of courage, would be quietly forgotten. Interpretation. When the Admiralty put its faith in Sir Hyde, it made a classical military error. It entrusted the waging of a war to a man who was careful and methodical. Such men may seem calm, even strong, in times of peace, but their self-control often hides weakness. The reason they think things through so carefully is that they are terrified of making a mistake, and of what that might mean for them and their career. This doesn't come out until they are tested in battle. Suddenly, they cannot make a decision. They see problems everywhere and defeat in the smallest setback. They hang back not out of patience, but out of fear. Often, these moments of hesitation spell their doom. Lord Nelson operated according to the opposite principle. Slight of build, with a delicate constitution, he compensated for his physical weakness with fierce determination. He forced himself to be more resolute than anyone around him. The moment he entered battle, he ratcheted up his aggressive impulses. Where other sea lords worried about casualties, the wind, changes in the enemy's formation, he concentrated on his plan. Before battle, no one strategized or studied his opponents more thoroughly. That knowledge helped Nelson to sense when the enemy was ready to crumble. But once the engagement began, hesitation and carefulness were dropped. Presence of mind is a kind of counterbalance to mental weakness, to our tendency to get emotional and lose perspective in the heat of battle. Our greatest weakness is losing heart, doubting ourselves, becoming unnecessarily cautious. Being more careful is not what we need. That is just a screen for our fear of conflict and of making a mistake. What we need is double the resolve, an intensification of confidence. That will serve as a counterbalance. In moments of turmoil and trouble, you must force yourself to be more determined. Call up the aggressive energy you need to overcome caution and inertia. Any mistakes you make, you can rectify with more energetic action still. Save your carefulness for the hours of preparation. But once the fighting begins, empty your mind of doubts. Ignore those who quail at any setback and call for retreat. Find joy in attack mode. Momentum will carry you through. From On War by Carl von Clausewitz. The senses make a more vivid impression on the mind than systematic thought. Even the man who planned the operation and now sees it being carried out may well lose confidence in his earlier judgment. War has a way of masking the stage with scenery crudely daubed with fearsome apparitions. Once this is cleared away, and the horizon becomes unobstructed, developments will confirm his earlier convictions. This is one of the great chasms between planning and execution. The Detached Buddha Tactic. Watching the movie director Alfred Hitchcock, 1899 to 1980, at work on a film set, was often quite a surprise to those seeing it for the first time. Most filmmakers are wound up balls of energy, yelling at the crew and barking out orders. But Hitchcock would sit in his chair, sometimes dozing, or at least with his eyes half closed. On the set of Strangers on a Train, made in 1951, the actor Farley Granger thought Hitchcock's behavior meant he was angry or upset, and asked him if anything was wrong. "Oh," Hitchcock replied sleepily, "I'm so bored." The crew's complaints and actor's tantrums, nothing fazed him. He would just yawn, shift in his chair, and ignore the problem. "Hitchcock didn't seem to direct us at all," said the actress Margaret Lockwood. "He was a dozing, nodding Buddha with an enigmatic smile on his face." It was hard for Hitchcock's colleagues to understand how a man doing such stressful work could stay so calm and detached. Some thought it was part of his character, that there was something inherently cold-blooded about him. Others thought it a gimmick, a put-on. Few suspected the truth. Before the filmmaking had even begun, Hitchcock would have prepared for it with such intense attention to detail that nothing could go wrong. He was completely in control. No temperamental actress, no panicky art director, no meddling producer could upset him or interfere with his plans. Feeling such absolute security in what he had set up, he could afford to lie back and fall asleep. Hitchcock's process began with a storyline, whether from a novel or an idea of his own. As if he had a movie projector in his head, he would begin to visualize the film. Next, he would start meeting with a writer, who would soon realize that this job was unlike any other. Instead of taking some producer's half-baked idea and turning it into a screenplay, the writer was simply there to put on paper the dream trapped in Hitchcock's mind. He or she would add flesh and bones to the characters and would, of course, write the dialogue, but not much else. When Hitchcock sat down with the writer Samuel Taylor for the first script meeting on the movie Vertigo, 1958, his descriptions of several scenes were so vivid, so intense, that the experiences seemed almost to have been real, or maybe something he had dreamed. This completeness of vision foreclosed creative conflict. As Taylor soon realized, although he was writing the script, it would remain a Hitchcock creation. Once the screenplay was finished, Hitchcock would transform it into an elaborate shooting script. Blocking, camera positions, lighting, and set dimensions were spelled out in detailed notes. Most directors leave themselves some latitude, shooting scenes from several angles, for example, to give the film editor options to work with later on. Not Hitchcock. He essentially edited the entire film in the shooting script. He knew exactly what he wanted and wrote it down. If a producer or actor tried to add or change a scene, Hitchcock was outwardly pleasant. He could afford to pretend to listen. But inside, he was totally unmoved. Nothing was left to chance. For the building of the sets, quite elaborate in a movie like Rear Window, Hitchcock would present the production designer with precise blueprints, floor plans, incredibly detailed lists of props. He supervised every aspect of set construction. He was particularly attentive to the clothes of his leading actresses. According to Edith Head, costumer on many Hitchcock movies, including Dial M for Murder in 1954, there was a reason for every color, every style, and he was absolutely certain about everything he settled on. For one scene, he saw Grace Kelly in pale green, for another in white chiffon, for another in gold. He was really putting a dream together in the studio. When the actress Kim Novak refused to wear a gray suit in Vertigo because she felt it made her look washed out, Hitchcock told her he wanted her to look like a woman of mystery who had just stepped out of the San Francisco fog. How could she argue with that? She wore the suit. Hitchcock's actors found working with him strange yet pleasant. Some of Hollywood's best, Joseph Cotten, Grace Kelly, Cary Grant, Ingrid Bergman, said that he was the easiest director to work for. His nonchalance was catching, and since his films were so carefully staged as not to depend on the actor's performance in any particular scene, they could relax. Everything went like clockwork. As James Stewart told the cast of The Man Who Knew Too Much, 1956, "We're in the hands of an expert here. You can lean on him. Just do everything he tells you and the whole thing will be okay." As Hitchcock sat calmly on the set, apparently half asleep, the cast and crew could see only the small part each one played. They had no idea how everything fit into his vision. When Taylor saw Vertigo for the first time, it was like seeing another man's dream. The film neatly duplicated the vision Hitchcock had expressed to him many months before. Interpretation. The first film Hitchcock directed was The Pleasure Garden, a silent he made in 1925. The production went wrong in every conceivable way. Hitchcock hated chaos and disorder. Unexpected events, panicky crew members, and any loss of control made him miserable. From that point on, he decided, he would treat filmmaking like a military operation. He would give his producers, actors, and crew no room to mess up what he wanted to create. He taught himself every aspect of film production, set design, lighting, the technicalities of cameras and lenses, editing, sound. He ran every stage of the film's making. No shadow could fall between the planning and the execution. Establishing control in advance, the way Hitchcock did, might not seem like presence of mind, but it actually takes that quality to its zenith. It means entering battle, in Hitchcock's case a film shoot, feeling calm and ready. Setbacks may come, but you will have foreseen them and thought of alternatives, and you are ready to respond. Your mind will never go blank when it is that well prepared. When your colleagues barrage you with doubts, anxious questions, and slipshod ideas, you may nod and pretend to listen, but really you're ignoring them. You've outthought them in advance. And your relaxed manner will prove contagious to other people, making them easier to manage in turn. It is easy to be overwhelmed by everything that faces you in battle, where so many people are asking or telling you what to do. So many vital matters press in on you that you can lose sight of your goals and plans. Suddenly you can't see the forest for the trees. Understand, presence of mind is the ability to detach yourself from all that, to see the whole battlefield, the whole picture, with clarity. All great generals have this quality. And what gives you that mental distance is preparation, mastering the details beforehand. Let people think your Buddha-like detachment comes from some mysterious source. The less they understand you, the better. From A Letter to a General by Frederick the Great. For the love of God, pull yourself together and do not look at things so darkly. The first step backward makes a poor impression in the army. The second step is dangerous, and the third becomes fatal. Keys to Warfare. We humans like to see ourselves as rational creatures. We imagine that what separates us from animals is the ability to think and reason. But that is only partly true. What distinguishes us from animals just as much is our capacity to laugh, to cry, to feel a range of emotions. We are, in fact, emotional creatures as well as rational ones, and although we like to think we govern our actions through reason and thought, what most often dictates our behavior is the emotion we feel in the moment. We maintain the illusion that we are rational through the routine of our daily affairs, which helps us to keep things calm and apparently controlled. Our minds seem rather strong when we're following our routines. But place any of us in an adverse situation, and our rationality vanishes. We react to pressure by growing fearful, impatient, confused. Such moments reveal us for the emotional creatures we are. Under attack, whether by a known enemy or unpredictably by a colleague, our response is dominated by feelings of anger, sadness, betrayal. Only with great effort can we reason our way through these periods and respond rationally. And our rationality rarely lasts past the next attack. Understand, your mind is weaker than your emotions. But you become aware of this weakness only in moments of adversity. precisely the time when you need strength. What best equips you to cope with the heat of battle is neither more knowledge nor more intellect. What makes your mind stronger and more able to control your emotions is internal discipline and toughness. No one can teach you this skill. You cannot learn it by reading about it. Like any discipline, it can come only through practice, experience, even a little suffering. The first step in building up presence of mind is to see the need for it, to want it badly enough to be willing to work for it. Historical figures who stand out for their presence of mind, Alexander the Great, Ulysses S. Grant, Winston Churchill, acquired it through adversity, through trial and error. They were in positions of responsibility in which they had to develop this quality or sink. Although these men may have been blessed with an unusual amount of personal fortitude, they had to work hard to strengthen this into presence of mind. The ideas that follow are based on their experience and hard-won victories. Think of these ideas as exercises, ways to toughen your mind, each a kind of counterbalance to emotion's overpowering pull. Expose yourself to conflict. George S. Patton came from one of America's most distinguished military families. His ancestors included generals and colonels who had fought and died in the American Revolution and the Civil War. Raised on stories of their heroism, he followed in their footsteps and chose a career in the military. But Patton was also a sensitive young man, and he had one deep fear, that in battle he would turn coward and disgrace the family name. Patton had his first real taste of battle in 1918 at the age of 32, during the Allied offensive on the Argonne during World War I. He commanded a tank division. At one point during the battle, Patton managed to lead some American infantrymen to a position on a hilltop overlooking a key strategic town, but German fire forced them to take cover. Soon it became clear that they were trapped. If they retreated, they would come under fire from positions on the sides of the hill. If they advanced, they would run right into a battery of German machine guns. If they were all to die, as it seemed to Patton, better to die advancing. At the moment he was to lead the troops in the charge, however, Patton was stricken by intense fear. His body trembled, and his legs turned to jelly. In a confirmation of his deepest fears, he had lost his nerve. At that instant, looking into the clouds beyond the German batteries, Patton had a vision. He saw his illustrious military ancestors, all in their uniforms, staring sternly down at him. They seemed to be inviting him to join their company, the company of dead war heroes. Paradoxically, the sight of these men had a calming effect on the young Patton. Calling for volunteers to follow him, he yelled, "It is time for another Patton to die." The strength had returned to his legs. He stood up and charged toward the German guns. Seconds later, he fell, hit in the thigh. But he survived the battle. From that moment on, even after he became a general, Patton made a point of visiting the front lines, exposing himself needlessly to danger. He tested himself again and again. His vision of his ancestors remained a constant stimulus, a challenge to his honor. Each time it became easier to face down his fears. It seemed to his fellow generals and to his own men that no one had more presence of mind than Patton. They did not know how much of his strength was an effort of will. The story of Patton teaches us two things. First, it is better to confront your fears, let them come to the surface, than to ignore them or tamp them down. Fear is the most destructive emotion for presence of mind, but it thrives on the unknown, which lets our imaginations run wild. By deliberately putting yourself in situations where you have to face fear, you familiarize yourself with it, and your anxiety grows less acute. The sensation of overcoming a deep-rooted fear in turn gives you confidence and presence of mind. The more conflicts and difficult situations you put yourself through, the more battle-tested your mind will be. Second, Patton's experience demonstrates the motivating power of a sense of honor and dignity. In giving in to fear, In losing your presence of mind, you disgrace not only yourself, your self-image, and your reputation, but your company, your family, your group. You bring down the communal spirit. Being a leader of even the smallest group gives you something to live up to. People are watching you, judging you, depending on you. To lose your composure would make it hard for you to live with yourself. Be self-reliant. There is nothing worse than feeling dependent on other people. Dependency makes you vulnerable to all kinds of emotions, betrayal, disappointment, frustration, that play havoc with your mental balance. Early in the American Civil War, General Ulysses S. Grant, eventual commander-in-chief of the Northern armies, felt his authority slipping. His subordinates would pass along inaccurate information on the terrain he was marching through. His captains would fail to follow through on his orders. His generals were criticizing his plans. Grant was stoical by nature, but his diminished control over his troops led to a diminished control over himself and drove him to drink. Grant had learned his lesson by the time of the Vicksburg campaign in 1862-63. He rode the terrain himself, studying it firsthand. He reviewed intelligence reports himself. He honed the precision of his orders, making it harder for his captains to flout them. And once he had made a decision, he would ignore his fellow general's doubts and trust his convictions. To get things done, he came to rely on himself. His feelings of helplessness dissolved, and with them all of the attendant emotions that had ruined his presence of mind. Being self-reliant is critical. To make yourself less dependent on others and so-called experts, you need to expand your repertoire of skills, and you need to feel more confident in your own judgment. Understand, we tend to overestimate other people's abilities. After all, they're trying hard to make it look as if they knew what they were doing, and we tend to underestimate our own. You must compensate for this by trusting yourself more and others less. It is important to remember, though, that being self-reliant does not mean burdening yourself with petty details. You must be able to distinguish between small matters that are best left to others and larger issues that require your attention and care. Suffer fools gladly. John Churchill, the Duke of Marlborough, is one of history's most successful generals. A genius of tactics and strategy, he had tremendous presence of mind. In the early 18th century, Churchill was often the leader of an alliance of English, Dutch, and German armies against the mighty forces of France. His fellow generals were timid, indecisive, narrow-minded men. They balked at the Duke's bold plans, saw dangers everywhere, were discouraged at the slightest setback, and promoted their own country's interests at the expense of the alliance. They had no vision, no patience. They were fools. The Duke, an experienced and subtle courtier, never confronted his colleagues directly. He did not force his opinions on them. Instead, he treated them like children, indulging them in their fears while cutting them out of his plans. Occasionally, he threw them a bone, doing some minor thing they had suggested or pretending to worry about a danger they had imagined. But he never let himself get angry or frustrated. That would have ruined his presence of mind, undermining his ability to lead the campaign. He forced himself to stay patient and cheerful. He knew how to suffer fools gladly. Understand, you cannot be everywhere or fight everyone. Your time and energy are limited, and you must learn how to preserve them. Exhaustion and frustration can ruin your presence of mind. The world is full of fools, people who cannot wait to get results, who change with the wind, who can't see past their noses. You encounter them everywhere. The indecisive boss, the rash colleague, the hysterical subordinate. When working alongside fools, do not fight them. Instead, think of them the way you think of children or pets, not important enough to affect your mental balance. Detach yourself emotionally. And while you're inwardly laughing at their foolishness, indulge them in one of their more harmless ideas. The ability to stay cheerful in the face of fools is an important skill. Crowd out feelings of panic by focusing on simple tasks. Lord Yamanouchi, an aristocrat of 18th century Japan, once asked his tea master to accompany him on a visit to Edo, later Tokyo, where he was to stay for a while. He wanted to show off to his fellow courtiers his retainer's skill in the rituals of the tea ceremony. Now, the tea master knew everything there was to know about the tea ceremony, but little else. He was a peaceful man. He dressed, however, like a samurai, as his high position required. One day, as the tea master was walking in the big city, he was accosted by a samurai who challenged him to a duel. The tea master was not a swordsman and tried to explain this to the samurai, but the man refused to listen. To turn the challenge down would disgrace both the tea master's family and Lord Yamanouchi. He had to accept, though that meant certain death. And accept he did, requesting only that the duel be put off to the next day. His wish was granted. In panic, the tea master hurried to the nearest fencing school. If he were to die, he wanted to learn how to die honorably. To see the fencing master ordinarily required letters of introduction, but the tea master was so insistent and so clearly terrified that at last he was given an interview. The fencing master listened to his story. The swordsman was sympathetic. He would teach the poor visitor the art of dying, but first, he wanted to be served some tea. The tea master proceeded to perform the ritual, his manner calm, his concentration perfect. Finally, the fencing master yelled out in excitement, "No need for you to learn the art of death. The state of mind you're in now is enough for you to face any samurai. When you see your challenger, imagine you're about to serve tea to a guest. Take off your coat, fold it up carefully, and lay your fan on it just as you do at work." This ritual completed, the tea master was to raise his sword in the same alert spirit. Then he would be ready to die. The tea master agreed to do as his teacher said. The next day he went to meet the samurai, who could not help but notice the completely calm and dignified expression on his opponent's face as he took off his coat. Perhaps, the samurai thought, this fumbling tea master is actually a skilled swordsman. He bowed, begged pardon for his behavior the day before, and hurried away. When circumstances scare us, our imagination tends to take over, filling our minds with endless anxieties. You need to gain control of your imagination, something easier said than done. Often, the best way to calm down and give yourself such control is to force the mind to concentrate on something relatively simple, a calming ritual, a repetitive task that you are good at. You are creating the kind of composure you naturally have when your mind is absorbed in a problem. A focused mind has no room for anxiety or for the effects of an overactive imagination. Once you have regained your mental balance, you can then face the problem at hand. At the first sign of any kind of fear, practice this technique until it becomes a habit. Being able to control your imagination at intense moments is a crucial skill. Unintimidate yourself. Intimidation will always threaten your presence of mind, and it is a hard feeling to combat. During World War II, the composer Dmitri Shostakovich and several of his colleagues were called into a meeting with the Russian ruler Joseph Stalin, who had commissioned them to write a new national anthem. Meetings with Stalin were terrifying. One misstep could lead you into a very dark alley. He would stare you down until you felt your throat tighten. And, as meetings with Stalin often did, this one took a bad turn. The ruler began to criticize one of the composers for his poor arrangement of his anthem. Scared silly, the man admitted he had used an arranger who had done a bad job. Here he was digging several graves. Clearly, the poor arranger could be called to task. The composer was responsible for the hire, and he too could pay for the mistake. And what of the other composers, including Shostakovich? Stalin could be relentless once he smelled fear. Shostakovich had heard enough. It was foolish, he said, to blame the arranger, who was mostly following orders. He then subtly redirected the conversation to a different subject: whether a composer should do his own orchestrations. What did Stalin think on the matter? Always eager to prove his expertise, Stalin swallowed the bait. The dangerous moment passed. Shostakovich maintained his presence of mind in several ways. First, instead of letting Stalin intimidate him, he forced himself to see the man as he was. Short, fat, ugly, unimaginative. The dictator's famous piercing gaze was just a trick, a sign of his own insecurity. Second, Shostakovich faced up to Stalin, talking to him normally and straightforwardly. By his actions and tone of voice, the composer showed that he was not intimidated. Stalin fed off fear. If, without being aggressive or brazen, you showed no fear, he would generally leave you alone. The key to staying unintimidated is to convince yourself that the person you're facing is a mere mortal, no different than you, which is in fact the truth. See the person, not the myth. Imagine him or her as a child, as someone riddled with insecurities. Cutting the other person down to size will help you to keep your mental balance. Develop your Fingerspitzengefühl, fingertip feel. Presence of mind depends not only on your mind's ability to come to your aid in difficult situations, but also on the speed with which this happens. Waiting until the next day to think of the right action to take does you no good at all. Speed here means responding to circumstances with rapidity and making lightning-quick decisions. This power is often read as a kind of intuition, what the Germans call Fingerspitzengefühl, fingertip feel. Erwin Rommel, who led the German tank campaign in North Africa during World War II, had great fingertip feel. He could sense when the Allies would attack and from what direction. In choosing a line of advance, he had an uncanny feel for his enemy's weakness. At the start of a battle, he could intuit his enemy's strategy before it unfolded. To Rommel's men, their general seemed to have a genius for war, and he did possess a quicker mind than most. But Rommel also did things to enhance his quickness, things that reinforced his feel for battle. First, he devoured information about the enemy, from details about its weaponry to the psychological traits of the opposing generals. Second, he made himself an expert in tank technology so that he could get the most out of his equipment. Third, he not only memorized maps of the North African desert, but would fly over it at great risk to get a bird's-eye view of the battlefield. Finally, he personalized his relationship with his men. He always had a sense of their morale and knew exactly what he could expect from them. Rommel didn't just study his men, his tanks, the terrain, and the enemy. He got inside their skin, understood the spirit that animated them, what made them tick. Having felt his way into these things, in battle, he entered a state of mind in which he did not have to think consciously of the situation. The totality of what was going on was in his blood, at his fingertips. He had Fingerspitzengefühl. Whether or not you have the mind of a Rommel, there are things you can do to help you respond faster and bring out that intuitive feel that all animals possess. Deep knowledge of the terrain will let you process information faster than your enemy, a tremendous advantage. Getting a feel for the spirit of men and material, thinking your way into them instead of looking at them from outside, will help to put you in a different frame of mind, less conscious and forced, more unconscious and intuitive. Get your mind into the habit of making lightning-quick decisions, trusting your fingertip feel. Your mind will advance in a kind of mental blitzkrieg, moving past your opponents before they realize what has hit them. Finally, do not think of presence of mind as a quality useful only in periods of adversity, something to switch on and off as you need it. Cultivate it as an everyday condition. Confidence, fearlessness, and self-reliance are as crucial in times of peace as in times of war. Franklin Delano Roosevelt showed his tremendous mental toughness and grace under pressure not only during the crises of the Depression and World War II, but in everyday situations, in his dealings with his family, his cabinet, his own polio-racked body. The better you get at the game of war, the more your warrior frame of mind will do for you in daily life. When a crisis does come, your mind will already be calm and prepared. Once presence of mind becomes a habit, it will never abandon you. Reversal. It is never good to lose your presence of mind, but you can use those moments when it is under threat to know how to act in the future. You must find a way to put yourself in the thick of battle, then watch yourself in action. Look for your own weaknesses and think about how to compensate for them. People who have never lost their presence of mind are actually in danger. Someday they will be taken by surprise and the fall will be harsh. All great generals, from Julius Caesar to Patton, have at some point lost their nerve and then have been the stronger for winning it back. The more you have lost your balance, the more you will know about how to right yourself. You do not want to lose your presence of mind in key situations, but it is a wise course to find a way to make your enemies lose theirs. Take what throws you off balance and impose it on them. Make them act before they are ready. Surprise them. Nothing is more unsettling than the unexpected need to act. Find their weakness, what makes them emotional, and give them a double dose of it. The more emotional you can make them, the farther you will push them off course. Here are further reflections on the strategy of counterbalance. From On War by Karl von Clausewitz. Presence of mind must play a great role in war, the domain of the unexpected, since it is nothing but an increased capacity of dealing with the unexpected. We admire presence of mind in an apt repartee as we admire quick thinking in the face of danger. The expression presence of mind precisely conveys the speed and immediacy of the help provided by the intellect. By Thomas Hardy. More life may trickle out of men through thought than through a gaping wound. From Military History of Ulysses S. Grant by Adam Badeau. So Grant was alone. His most trusted subordinates besought him to change his plans, while his superiors were astounded at his temerity and strove to interfere. Soldiers of reputation and civilians in high places condemned in advance a campaign that seemed to them as hopeless as it was unprecedented. If he failed, the country would concur with the government and the generals. Grant knew all this and appreciated his danger, but was as invulnerable to the apprehensions of ambition as to the entreaties of friendship, or the anxieties even of patriotism. That quiet confidence in himself, which never forsook him, and which amounted indeed almost to a feeling of fate, was uninterrupted. Having once determined in a matter that required irreversible decision, he never reversed, not even misgave, but was steadily loyal to himself and his plans. This absolute and implicit faith was, however, as far as possible from conceit or enthusiasm. It was simply a consciousness or conviction, rather, which brought the very strength it believed in, which was itself strength, and which inspired others with the trust in him, because he was able thus to trust himself. From Legends of the Samurai by Hiroaki Sato. There was once a man who may be called the generalissimo of robbers, and who went by the name of Hakamadare. He had a strong mind and a powerful build. He was swift of foot, quick with his hands, wise in thinking and plotting. Altogether, there was no one who could compare with him. His business was to rob people of their possessions when they were off guard. Once, around the 10th month of a year, he needed clothing and decided to get hold of some. He went to prospective spots and walked about, looking. About midnight, when people had gone to sleep and were quiet, under a somewhat blurry moon, he saw a man dressed in abundant clothes sauntering about on a boulevard. The man, with his trouser skirt tucked up with strings, perhaps, and in a formal hunting robe which gently covered his body, was playing the flute, alone, apparently in no hurry to go to any particular place. Wow, here's the fellow who's shown up just to give me his clothes, Hakamadara thought. Normally, he would have gleefully run up and beaten his quarry down and robbed him of his clothes. But this time, unaccountably, he felt something fearsome about the man, so he followed him for a couple of hundred yards. The man himself didn't seem to think, "Somebody's following me." On the contrary.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.